hatched his egg for a raw one, and when we broke it, it went all over him in a marvellously memorable moment when he stood up in his chair and revealed to all of the audience and all of Australia that all he had on under the desk was his underpants. You see, he did every show in his underpants.
Oh, there's a nasty bit.
Here I am, the duck hunter, wading through the shallows.
Wading.
Graham's role as a film star was very, very good. People who know say Graham could easily have become an Australian Academy Award winner if he'd pursued the celluloid career.
Well, no one's going to sack me. I've just resigned.
Time to go, Harry. Makes you wonder, doesn't it? A whole morning's work. But nothing.
For all we know, we may never meet again. Before you go, make this moment sweet again.
He was responsible for so many of the people who, through him, became big. You know, there's a whole a gang of them out there, or that all know that they owe whatever careers they've got to Graham. He just created so many things and did so many really good things. You know, comedy wise, he was great, and also he could sing a little too. You know.
Commercials on television, Graham's idea about all that was that they were pretty boring, so he had to do something to make them funny. And he would do anything he could to make us forget our lines. In those days, there were no auto cues or idiot sheets, as they were called, with words on them to remind you about what you were speaking about. So he would try to throw you any way he could. And of course, the famous one he did was the crow call.
Renounce my faith! Never, never!
We've all learned so much from Graham, and there'll be many imitators through the years, but he was truly unique.
Why, shut up!
I think one of the great moments that is famous about Graham was where his dog Rover started pissing all over the set.
Rover?
And they couldn't stop him.
Oh, he's...
Do you mind me kissing you after just having kissed Abigail?
I'd just like to thank Graham for all the happiness that he's brought to most people in Australia, and especially to Tony and me. We'll miss you.
For all we know.
They're just some of the amazing moments from Graham Kennedy's career. Tony, you look at those things, they still make us laugh. Why is his humour so timeless?
Well, he has that great combination of blatant physical comedy. He has that, which is terrific. And the timing, you know, that's just talent, you know. And he also, the idea, as a tribute, obviously, today, we are pants off under the desk, pants off for the king. Just the idea of the hidden joke with Kennedy is as good as the one that he tells, I think.
And he always said that he wasn't much of a singer, but he could sing.
He's a cabaret singer. He's great. The fashions from 77, Blankety Blanks, when that started, was just, you know, the powder blue suits and the blue humour basically went hand in hand.
And the sequins as well.
Yeah, he can carry off a sequin.
Fantastic. Now, a whole lot of people have begun arriving, as we saw earlier, for Graham Kennedy's funeral. Let's take a look at some of the people. The theatre itself can only hold about 200 people, so there are going to be a lot of people outside the theatre today. I think earlier we saw Nolene Brown, Tony Sattler, two of his great friends arriving, didn't we? Here they are here.
That's right, because they were in the Southern Highlands. When Graham Kennedy moved to the Southern Highlands to live, they, of course, had found the house. They lived nearby. They were carers for Graham Kennedy, friends and obviously colleagues. There's Tony Barber, of course.
It's quite incredible the number of people that he was friends with. Yeah.
John Paul Young, maybe in fact doing a bit of music, I think, for us during the ceremony, was on Blankety Blanks. And there's John Mangos and his lovely wife Tani.
And he was privy to those pants off under the desk.
He was indeed. He came in after two dogs, Kenny Sutcliffe, on Coast to Coast.
We'll now welcome our viewers from South Australia and Western Australia who've joined us for our live coverage of Graham Kennedy's funeral here today. Of course, we'll be taking you live to Mittagong for the funeral, which is just about to get underway.
Graham didn't want a funeral service, and he didn't want any religious rites. So I think today this is a bon voyage gathering from his friends and his admirers all over Australia. And here we are in a small theatre, which is very appropriate because some of Graham's earliest performances were in what is literally called the Little Theatre, which is now the St. Martin's, in Melbourne. Now, theatre is a place of laughter and applause. Things which Graham and indeed every performer loves to hear. So don't be inhibited by the solemnity of the occasion. Where appropriate, let's hear laughter, let's hear applause, as indeed you've already started doing. Thank you. There's been a lot of tributes coming to Graham, and a full house here is a sign of that, something he would have welcomed, and hopefully a lot of ratings at home. The tributes have come in from all over. He was much loved, and there's no better epitaph for anyone than to say he was much loved. I'd like to give my own tributes to some other people who cared for Graham in the last years of his life. Tony Sattler and Nolene Brown made... In his last couple of years, they gave Graham comfort and dignity. And also to Sam Chisholm, who made sure the bills were paid. Delivering a eulogy for a close friend and for someone who is so much admired is never a happy occasion. Though I must confess I would be quite happy to deliver a eulogy for a certain media personality who's tried the second Kennedy assassination of our time. And failed. I have some messages here from people who've worked with Graham, from Rosemary Margin in Melbourne, who was with Graham on IMT. Rosemary says, "My special times with you will never be forgotten. The funny, the clever, the sad, you'll always be in my heart. Thanks for the memories." And from Barry Creighton in Hollywood, he says, "Graham was the very foundation of Australian television. He was the boldest entertainer of not only his generation, but possibly of any generation in the television medium. There was only one Graham Kennedy, and he was indeed the king." Today, in this audience, there's a wonderful feeling of affection, and that's personified in the lyrics of this song, which is going to be sung to us by John Paul Young.
Love is in the air, everywhere I look around. Love is in the air, every sight and every sound. And I don't know if I'm being foolish, don't know if I'm being wise, but it's something that I must believe in. It's the way that look in your eyes. Love is in the air, in the whisper of the trees. the sun. Lovers in the air when the day's nearly done. And I don't know if you're illusion, don't know if I see it true, but you're something that I must believe in, and you're there when I reach out for you. Love is in the air, everywhere I look around. Love is in the air, every sight and every sound. And I don't know if I'm being foolish, don't know if I'm being wise, but it's something that I must believe in, and it's there when I look in your eyes. Love is in the air.
Thank you, John. I have a feeling that's not the first time you've sung that. It's now my pleasure to introduce a lady who is a close friend, a carer, and a co-star, and a wonderful lady, Nolene Brown.
I didn't think Graham was ever going to die. I thought a few times we got close and we had memorial services organised and he got better. So I was always expecting him to get better. In fact, I said to Tony, he's going to outlive both of us. So I've just got a few memories of Graham when he came to live in the Southern Highlands. They're not early show business memories, but he was really happy here because he was almost anonymous. Everyone knew it was Graham wearing a disguise, but they just sort of wave and pass by. He had a wonderful time living on his farm with his wonderful big Clydesdale horse, an ex-Carlton United draft horse, and a beautiful dog called Henry. Henry's mother is here today. She wanted me to know Mari's here. I'd just like to tell you about how he acquired Henry. He had a vet living nearby who said, I think you should have, you've got your horse, you should have your dog. So he said, well, yes, I'd like to audition a few dogs. So he went along to Mari and Mari's husband's, and they bred golden retrievers. And he thought that there was one that was small and was the runt of the pack and had been castrated because no good for breeding purposes. So Graham said, I decided on Henry because all the other dogs were poking fun at him because he had no balls. So they were wonderful friends, and Mari brought along a photograph of Henry, and that's going to go with Graham and is going to be cremated, because Mari and I both believe that Henry and Graham are going to be together in heaven. But when when Graham first came to live here, he asked me where I shopped, so I told him a few places to go. And he lived at Canyon Lee, and the place I used to go for my veggies was at Scarlett's at Burrowang, a distance of some 40 k's from Canyon Lee. So Graham went there one day and he got his veggies, and a woman was looking at him, a person who must have been a local, and she said, when he'd gone to the greengrocer, was that Graham Kennedy? And he said, yes, it was. And she said, does he come all this way to get his veggies? And
And he said, yes, because it was 40 or 50 Ks. And she said, that's amazing. He lives in Melbourne. So he had another mate who was a butcher, who's also here today, David Farrell. And they became really good mates. And it was David used to call Graham Mr. K, and Graham used to call David Farrell Mr. F. And occasionally they'd have a little drink of red wine in the freezer sometimes. But Graham, who was offered many, many thousands of dollars to do commercials and would knock them back, said, would you like me to do your radio commercials on 2ST for David Farrell? And the cost of those commercials to Graham was a couple of chops and some sausages and some meat for Henry. So he rang his agent, James Laurie, my agent too, and said, would you like half a sausage by way of commission? So they're the happy times that Graham had here. When he became ill this last time, and we knew that he was probably not going to last, we're actually arranging for a meeting with Daryl Summers before he got ill, so I'm sorry, Daryl, that never happened. But I visited him many times, and even though he was under, you know, a lot of medication, he'd wake up and he'd smile, he'd say, hello, darling, and I'd say, is there anything you like? And he loved Passiona, was his favourite last drink, which might come as a surprise to everyone who knew that he loved Grange. So when I came in on the last day, about 10 hours before he died, I said, darling, is there anything you would like? Would you like an ice cream? Because he liked ice cream as well. And he made a noise rather like the crow call and said, that'd be crow call, great. So he had a couple of mouthfuls of ice cream, and I left him not realising that he would die about 10 hours later. But one of the nurses who's here today told me that the doctor spoke to him and said, Graham, this time your pneumonia is really, really serious. And he said, what do you mean, doctor? Really serious? He said, yes, Graham, it's really serious. And they realised that this would be it. So the doctor said, is there anything you'd like to ask me, Graham? And he said, yes. Why do you doctors charge so much? So, I think that's all I've got to say about Graham, except I loved him, he was family, and I'll miss him, but he'll always be here. Next person to talk about him will be John Mangos, who is his mate and friend from Coast to Coast days, but has always been there visiting him. John Mangos.
Thank you, Nolene. He loved you, too. I want to talk about the things that Graham loved. He'd have loved the squabble over broadcast rights for this event. You see, he used to love people fighting over him because it pushed the price up. And if he were here with us alive today, he'd have loved diving into the Macquarie Dictionary and finding just the right words to describe it. A charaban of pensioners outside. A condescension of actors inside. Of course, he loved the Macquarie Dictionary, mostly because it had his name in it. Page 1263, under the word Logie. He was always very quick to remind me of that. Would he have loved the fuss? He'd have said not, but inside he really would have. As much as he rejected love, he craved it. He loved being a star, and as Stuart mentioned earlier, he certainly loved the applause. He also loved being alone. He loved his food and he loved eating out. He loved his first beer at midday, his red wine with lunch, the first gin and tonic at 5 o'clock, and he especially loved it when it was contra and he didn't have to pay for it. He'd love assassinating characters over a glass of wine or two. Most of you, actually. And he loved frustrating you. He loved knowing that the harder you tried to make contact with him, the more elusive he became. He loved his waterfront at Kirribilli. How inconsiderate, he would say, John, of couples to make love within view on the foreshore. I'd say, yes, Graham, very inconsiderate. He says, do you know how hard it is to hold a pair of binoculars in one hand? But my fondest memories are not necessarily those of the shows we did together or Kirribilli, but of course, as Nolene mentioned, our very warm and loving friendship afterwards. The years at Canyon Lea, on the property he called Clydesdale after the horses that he loved so very much. He was always the perfect host. He loved being the perfect host. As some of you would know, the table was always set immaculately, always the appropriate cutlery, the appropriate crockery for that specific meal, always. And of course, as most of you would know, most of it was stolen from Qantas First Class over years of travel. Those were the days when it was Wedgwood. In fact, once upon learning of my travel plans, he said, which airline are you flying, John? And I told him, Qantas. He said, great. He said, would you be kind enough to get me a saucer? He said, I've broken one and now my set is incomplete. I naturally said I'd oblige, and then I grappled with the guilt. Do I steal one or do I ask for one? Well, as it turns out, I ended up with two saucers, because I did both. And then I sent the triumphant fax, announcing that, Graham, what a hero I am. Not one, but I have procured two saucers. And immediately came the reply on the fax machine within seconds. Shit, now I need another cup. As many of the people who worked with him would tell you, he loved the fax machine. It gave him ultimate control. He could answer what he wanted and when he wanted, and of course, he loved control. He loved acting. By now, most of you know that most of it was an act. He was really quite insecure and shy. He was never comfortable with undeserved familiarity or vulgarity. And yet, when he was acting, he mastered vulgarity and he dumped it in our living rooms and we lapped it up. We loved it. One of his favourite stories, in fact, on the subject of vulgarity, because he loved his dictionaries, was the woman at the launch of the Funken Wagnalls. Remember he used to talk about the Funken Wagnalls dictionary? A woman who complained to one of the authors that it was a fine journal indeed, but what a shame they had scooped so low as to include the F word. And Graham absolutely loved the response of the author. Thank you, madam, but how very low of you for noticing and looking for it. He loved his pencils. He surrounded himself with dozens of cups holding pencils. He loved his pencils because they reminded him of his poverty-stricken childhood when he couldn't afford pencils. He loved Melbourne and he loved the St Kilda Footy Club. And it's nice to see the boys here from the club. And he told me once he loved it when, as King of Moomba, he was helicopter dropped into the middle of the MCG in front of 120,000 people. How do you top that, John? He said to me. He loved being Frank Sinatra's warm-up act during a tour of Australia. He especially loved a gag that he and Frank Sinatra concocted for the after-show parties. He organised it so that Sinatra would come up to him at the after-show party, as if to come up and talk to Graham. And Graham had it all worked out. He'd go, leave me alone, Brian, can't you see I'm busy? Frankie played along with it. He loved it when a young floor wax salesman called Sam Chisholm got down on his hands and knees to polish the floor at Frankston. He still loved you, Sam, even when you became his boss. He adored you. He loved it when he was thrown off air for the crow call. Let me tell you a little bit about the background there. He was working Variety 5 nights a week. And just like Johnny Carson, he wanted to cut it back to 2 nights a week. It was too much hard work. The network refused, so he broke his contract by breaching broadcast laws, got himself kicked off the air. Yep, he loved being off the air, and then he loved being back at the same network about a year later. Guess what? Doing two shows a night. He got his way. He loved me, and he loved my mum. My mum's name's Dot, but he would call her Diamantina. He was on her cooking list, you see. Every Easter and every Christmas, he'd get the Greek Easter cookies and the Greek Christmas cookies. He loved those. He loved inquiring about my upbringing, and he loved family meals together. In fact, he even came to some Mangos family meals together. He seemed to love reliving things that maybe he'd missed out upon in his childhood. I'll close by saying our friend Graham loved a lot of things. I just wish he'd have loved himself as much as we loved him. I'd like to now introduce biographer Graham Blundell. Graham, of course, worked with our Graham in two movies, The Odd Angry Shot and Don's Party. Graham Blundell.
Graham Kennedy will always be remembered as Mr. Melbourne by the generations who grew up with him in that city the way I did. The rest of Australia, of course, called him the King, or just Graham. And for 30 years, he was our biggest star. In my time, it was Graham who first led television's comedy charge. He was there at the very beginning, hurling custard pies with jubilation on In Melbourne Tonight, giving his audience countless laughs that were really metaphoric comments, not only on how we lived day to day, but if we really thought about it at all, on the nature of humankind, its frailty, deceptiveness and trickiness. When relaxed and flying in top form, he was impossible to keep up with. It was said that he could read an audience like skywriting. He'd come from radio, but we loved the way that he spent his life laughing at the orthodoxies of television, externalising its workings, lifting his slim digit to its pieties. We talked about it on the buses and the trains and the trams next morning, sending everything and everybody up mercilessly while the studio audience shrieked and howled. There were the trademark fish eyes that said one wag made him look like a famished barracuda. Those ocular reactions, the blank stares and smug looks, and the lightning double takes that were the special Kennedy things. The way he darted around, a pale figure in a dapper suit. He was always dressed to the nines. His assurance was breathtaking as he did his cheeky schoolboy act, igniting outrageous feasts of timing and audience control. The oyster-eyed boy, journalists found a thousand ways to describe his features, and he didn't like all of them, was hired by Melbourne's new Channel 9 with imitations of the American Tonight shows of Steve Allen in mind. But that initial source of inspiration would never curb the local kid's style. The only similarity was that Graham sat at a desk most of the time. He dealt not in urbanity, but in a manageable sort of iconoclasm, and his timing was right, wrote TV critic Sandra Hall in the 70s. He arrived just before seeing Tonight Show compares fail had been permitted to become just another national sport. It was Graham who first taught us about television. He gravitated towards television like a tuning fork, Noel Ferrier once said, and its power to displace such commodities in our lives as conversation and solitude. Graham was always able to turn adversity into a kind of triumph, ordinariness into adventure of the riskiest kind, and subtle sexual subtext into broad social acceptance. With Bert Newton, he did crosstalk comedy with the immediacy of reminiscing brothers. Sometimes they looked at each other as if searching a shared memory. He believed no single performer in the history of the world had so often been dropped down, blown up, hit, hurt, crushed, smashed, exploded, drowned, shot, clouted, bashed, and generally physically embarrassed more than he had. He reigned over local television for 40 years as talk show host, game show presenter, satirist, commentator, and as an actor of great quality when briefly he left TV for the film industry. In retirement, he was as modest of his achievements as might be expected of someone who had achieved so much. In his final act of retirement as a living example of the truth that a life lived is more valuable than the creation of any artwork. Graham Kennedy always understood too that in show business, hitting what you aim at is what counts, and above all, knowing when to quit. The show-off, clacking slapstick clown was stage managed by a sophisticated, lonely man who always knew when the party was over. I think people like watching me because I carry on as I would like to if they were put in front of an audience. In front of people, he once said. I don't classify myself as a comedian, though sometimes I'm funny. I can't really sing and I can't dance. I can't really interview anyone, but I can talk. A famous person once said about me that I didn't do anything on television, but I did it better than anyone else. Ladies and gentlemen, some clips of Graham Kennedy doing just that.
Good evening. Don't you hate that commercial? Yesterday I wasn't faring very well. No, I couldn't play with Sharon. I couldn't play with my teddy bear. But last night, Mummy gave me a chocolate.
Did she ever?
Bang!
What do you do for a living, Julie?
I'm a typist.
A typist.
Mm.
At an insurance broker.
No.
At a solicitor's office.
No.
At Coles and Garrard, the famous people who make wonderful sunglasses.
No.
No. Oh, you might be with Massey Ferguson, the people who make wonderful tractors. You're not, by any chance, with Rid milking machines, are you?
No.
Is it possible, one says to oneself, that you're with Custom Carpets?
No.
I know, the Fridge Right Dairy Vat people.
No.
You're at the Drew and Butterfat Factory. Well, I've guessed as much as I can and got rid of a few debts.
Jumping around to relax. How do you feel tonight?
Fine!
Oh, shut up, you lover.
An animal lover who thought he'd bred a one-eyed cat discovered that it was entering the room backwards.
You can do so much with them. It's like a foundation for an exciting meal. And I'm at Sayo. Not only that, you can make vanilla slices. Have you seen that commercial? Nice homemade vanilla slice made out of 2 Sayo biscuits. Now about that, sounds like dysentery, doesn't it? I don't have to eat it tonight, do it. I do have to.
Oh, that's good, because I love it.
What flavour have we got tonight?
Blueberry.
The little black things.
Yuck.
No, it's good, though. It's good. It's Peter's real fruit yogurt, and it tastes delicious.
I beg your pardon?
Take them off.
Oh, all right. There you are. Dick was dining at the restaurant.
Dick was.
Was Dick ever?
Clever Dick.
Yes. How tall was Dick?
Oh, Dick's about 6'7".
Big Dick.
The 1978 Gold Logie winner is Graham Kennedy.
I would very much like to thank me for having faith in the Reg Grundy organisation. Was that little bit meant to be humorous at all? Because I've got a hot flash for you.
Graham, I think you need to buy the Women's Weekly to find the answer to that.
Oh, right. Well, I'll get my copy shortly. I would do their commercials, you know, if they arrive 72 hours before showtime. But when they tell it sit down on the same day, I refuse.
Well, let me tell you, I'm happy to be here.
I've got a glandular. Isn't that revolting? I knew Sir Frank too, of course.
Graham, you are a bit of a knocker lately. Won't you say one positive thing about someone before the Christmas break? All right, I will. You are a it's positive.
I can't go into my first erotic experience. I can't expand on that. I mean, I remember it as being a very tender, wonderful moment. I just wished at the time, I remember thinking, clearly, I wish I had some company.
I'd walk a million miles for one of your smiles. Mummy.
That's Sam Sutton. We wanted you to meet him. It's just a thrill. Yes, that is a nicely framed picture. Spot Graham Kennedy.
5, 4, 3.
two.
Oh, there you are.
Well, firstly, an apology for not being with you today. You can imagine how much I would like to be there. Graham used to joke with me about the fact that I loved going to a funeral. He used to say it in the nicest possible way. Once he said to me he'd go to the funeral of a joke that died. Do you know, not too many jokes died with Graham around. If they were dying, all of a sudden he'd throw away the script or throw away the intention of the sketch or the little bit at the desk and start afresh with something new until those laughs started to come again. But we all know that was the sort of performer Graham was. Today, I just want to let you know something that I'm sure you know anyway. Apart from being the best television performer this country has ever seen, it's also worthwhile remembering that the influence that he had on television was quite amazing, the likes of which I can't remember anybody else in one particular medium having the influence that Graham had in television. I said on my show, Good Morning Australia, last Friday morning, that a lot of people are saying that Graham changed Australian television. It's not totally accurate because Graham Kennedy basically started Australian television in terms of Tonight shows and chat shows and variety generally. And I know that I wouldn't be sitting here on the set of Good Morning Australia. I don't think Rove would be sitting on the set of Rove Live and all of the other compeers with their shows. They may be working in television, but I don't think they'd be doing precisely what they're doing and what I'm doing. If we were working in television, there's every chance we'd be repairing television sets because before, months after the start of television in Australia, when Graham started in Melbourne Tonight, it was a whole new vista, not just for Australia, but for the world too, because it started out, or supposed to be, and I'm sure you know the story, a Tonight Show like Johnny Carson and Steve Allen and Jack Parr and all of those people, but Graham just made it his own. The only similarity was the fact that there was a desk there and there were songs. From a personal point of view, I've known Graham for 50 years. We first met in 1955 when we were both in radio. He was at the Greater 3UZ and I was at the quality station, 3XY. And the friendship began in 1955 and has lasted ever since. A friendship that I hold so dearly. The memories are great, I know, for all of us. And my memory of Graham Kennedy is not just as that wonderful television personality, but somebody with whom it was terrific to spend time. He liked the good things in life. A lot of people say he was a recluse. I know that Noeline and Tony don't agree with that word, nor do I, because he was private and he was shy. But that doesn't make someone a recluse. And speaking of Tony and Noeline, I just wanted to say, from friends who won't be there on this occasion that you're attending, thank you for looking after Graham Kennedy. It hasn't been just something over the last couple of weeks or a couple of months. We're talking about years. He was very lucky to have friends like you, Noeline, and Tony. And I know you considered yourselves lucky that he was your friend. The whole thing was summed up for me on Wednesday of last week when the news came through. Not just the sadness at Graham passing away, but I think Noeline said it for all of us when she said, I saw him only hours before he died. I was sleeping, I was dreaming of Graham, the phone rang and the news came through. And Noeline's last line was, I wish I'd been there to hold his hand. Noeline, that's how we all feel. And thank you for letting me say these few words.
Bird Newton, who keeps the flag flying for the standard that Graham set every day on his Good Morning Australia show and every evening on stage with the producers. I don't know how he does it. If I might digress just for a moment, Noeline, You learned a lot from Graham. Graham was the king of the freebies, and today you have mentioned every tradesman in Barrel you will eat for free for you. Bert's wife, Patty, has sent this message. All that Bert has said about Graham is how I feel. I've always loved him personally and professionally. Graham used to say on IMT, we're going to make a star of Patty McGraw. Well, that didn't happen, but I got to work with the king, and that made me at least feel like a star. Graham, you'll always be in my heart. I've also got a message from Carol Ray, who was with us on Blankety Blanks, and Carol said, I never ceased to be amazed at his professionalism and skill. In show after show, he made it seem so easy, more like play than work. I'll always remember his mischievous, irreverent, and bawdy sense of humor. His contribution to our profession has been enormous. Graham loved writers. He realized, as we all come to eventually, that without the writers, there is no show. Right from the early days with Freddie Parsons and Ernie Carroll, right up to Gary Riley and Tony Sadler, he admired them all. And someone who wrote for all of us who were at Channel 9 in those days was the gentleman who we're going to hear from now, Mr. Mike McCall Jones.
Thank you, Stuart. We all know Graham loved the fax machine. He loved receiving faxes, but he particularly loved sending faxes. I was wondering this morning just what I could say. And I received a fax from Graham from heaven. God knows how he got the number. I guess that's how he got the number. And I thought I might read it to you. So this is a fax from Graham from heaven. Dear Mike, speak up and don't faint. Graham knows how terrified I am. You know how much I loathe flying. This was the smoothest flight I ever had. Not one bump. Good airline food too. Great airline, Air God. It was fascinating to see airline food being served by nuns. When I arrived, I was greeted by this old bloke with a white beard. He looked like me in sketches. I helped him drag some cases of grog in through the pearly gates, which, by the way, are plastic. Gee, they think of everything up here. 50 crates of gin and tonic and a lovely bucket of ice, all ready for me. The guy I helped is already a chum. I call him St. Peter the Phantom Puller. Met some really interesting people on the weekend. Henry VIII. He told me he liked the way I threw the chicken on the floor for Bert to pick up. John Logie Baird. He said he's going to name an award after me, the Cyril. And Dick Turpin. He told me a very funny joke. Did Dick? Dick did. Clever Dick. Dead Dick. Page two. I hear Darren outed me. I've got a hot flash for him. It's rife up here. Only a few minutes ago, I saw Oscar Wilde holding hands with Chips Rafferty. I reckon if Hinch's body is ever washed up on a beach, police will be interviewing suspects for 7 years. I'm having a drink tonight at the Cloud Club with some old chums. Joff, Rosie, Norm Spencer, Johnny Ladd, Buster Fidesz, Tommy Hanlon, senior and junior, Al Jolson, Dean Martin, and you'll never guess who the barman is, Johnny Million. Do you know who I saw on Friday afternoon? Rover Boy, Rover the Wonder Dog. He's still peeing. I must go now. I'm about to meet the big G, God. I said he could come over at 2 o'clock. Love to Tony, Nolene, and all. Graham. Oh, there's a PS. PS. I almost forgot. You'll never guess who I had dinner with last night. Joan of... On behalf of Freddie Parsons, Ernie Carroll, my family, all Australians, and particularly Melburnians, thank you, Graham. If Graham ever wanted to lift a show when it was flagging, he always got the audience to move into it and help along with some songs. This is really hard for me because it does involve singing. We do have the leader of the Mittagong Glee Club here. And one of Graham's favourites was the Chum song. So I urge you all to sing along a lot louder than me, please. Being a chum is fun, that is why I'm one. Always smiling, always gay, chummy at work and chummy at play. Laugh away your worries, don't be sad or glum, and everyone will know that you're a chum, chum, chum. Faster, Geoffrey?
Certainly.
Being a chum is fun, that is why I'm one. Always smiling, always gay, chummy at work and chummy at play. Laugh away your worries, don't be sad or glum, and everyone will know that you're a chum, chum, chum. Thank you very much.
Always smiling, always gay. They don't write songs like that anymore, do they? Music was always a great part of Graham's life. He loved it. And who can forget the duets he did with Evie Hayes, with Elaine McKenna, and with this wonderful lady who's coming on now, who was indeed a compere herself of IMT, the first woman compere of a Tonight Show in the world, the inimitable Miss Toni Lamond.
When Graham was at his height, I was in musical theatre, and he used to say to me, "Gee, Lamond, you're so lucky to do a musical." There he was, king of the world, but he would love to have done a stage musical, most particularly How to Succeed in Business Without Really Trying. He never got to do it, but I'll bet if heaven's what I think it is, right now he's auditioning for Frank Lesser, the composer. And this is in your honour, darling. You have the cool, clear eyes of a seeker of wisdom and truth. Yet there's that upturned chin and that grin of impetuous youth. Oh, I believe in you. The sound of good, solid judgment whenever you talk. Yet there's that bold, brave spring of a tiger that quickens your walk. Oh, I believe in you. I believe in you. And when my faith in my fellow man all but falls apart, I've just to see your hand grasping mine, and I take heart to see the cool, clear eyes of a seeker of wisdom and truth. Yet there's that slam, bang, tang, reminiscent of gin and vermouth. And when my faith in my fellow man all but falls apart, I've but to feel your hand grasping mine, and I take heart to see the clear, cool eyes of a seeker of wisdom and truth. Yet there's that slam, bang, tang, reminiscent of gin and vermouth. I believe in you, Graham, darling. I always believed in you.
Thank you, Tony. It's wonderful to look around this audience here today and see so many people from the early days of television. It's a bit like walking through Madame Tussauds, but... In the 70s, Graham started a new career as a film actor, and a very successful career it was. He took up the challenge with his usual aplomb, and again, he valued the writers more than anything. And a gentleman who wrote three of the movies in which Graham played is here to play tribute, Mr. David Williamson.
I first saw Graham when I was only 16. He was on IMT. The impact was enormous on me. Suddenly, staid, puritanical Melbourne was undermined and subverted by his wicked, impish spirit. Graham became our alter ego, the person we would have loved to have been if only we'd been as talented, quick, witty, and wickedly evil as he was. So it was a great thrill for me that this talented man, my boyhood hero, brought to life so wonderfully three of my characters in a way no one else could have done. Ted Parker, the pie manufacturing president of the club that hadn't won a premiership for 19 years. He created a poignant and touching portrait of a man out of his depth, a man whose tragedy was that he never had the ability to play the game he loved with the team he loved, a man who didn't know the knives were out for him already. And I'll always treasure the way Graham played his final scene. The axe had fallen, and he gathered all his frail dignity, and our heart went out to him as he was banished from the club he loved. And the sad, bewildered loser, Mac, in Don's Party, wondering why life had never worked out for him. And as the lonely neighbour Freddie in Travelling North, craving the friendship that Leo McKern was very reluctant to give him. Yes, Graham could make us laugh. Yes, his comic timing was impeccable. But Graham could also create a character your heart went out to, that you cared about and almost wept for. And that's the mark of a great actor, one who can wear human frailty on his sleeve and make us laugh and cry. Graham has passed on, but his huge talent will be with us forever on the big screen, and for that I'm tremendously grateful. Now, Jack Thompson can't be here today in person, but the morning wouldn't be complete without a word from him. Thank you.
Thank you for introducing me to Graham, because if we hadn't done the club together, then I probably wouldn't have got to know him quite so well. He was a good friend. But I had already met Graham on a number of occasions. Whenever we made another film and went out there to promote it, Graham always provided us with the most fabulous support. He was a great supporter of the Australian film industry, and ultimately made a great contribution to it in his portrayal of Ted in the club. I think one of the great comedy performances of Australian film. You were not only the king, mate. You were our court jester. We'll miss you. Valet, Graham.
Graham wasn't a religious man, but if he has gone to meet his maker, I like to think that the scene is pretty much as depicted in Bill Leake's cartoon, which is on the back of your programmes, and I think, perhaps not, coming up on the screen, it's There is Graham arriving in heaven to a great mob of his old chums welcome him with a mighty hurrah. No, it's not coming up. It was a good idea at the time. Graham is going to have the final word, as always. He sings For All We Know, and as he does that, the president, the coach, the captain, and the members of his beloved St Kilda AFL team will be bearing him away. When that happens, let's give him one mighty last standing ovation, shall we? Here is Graham to sing For All We Know. Goodbye, Graham. We'll miss you.
We know we may never meet again. Before you go, make this moment sweet again. We won't say
stand up and see it, please.
You're watching live pictures as Graham Kennedy's coffin leaves the Playhouse Theatre in Mittagong, where he's just been farewelled by several hundred of his friends and colleagues from the television industry. Tony Squires, I don't quite know how we follow that. That was quite a show.
It was amazing to see the applause as you left. And for a young person like this, in Kilda Captain Nick Riewoldt, there are probably plenty of young kids who actually had never seen Graham Kennedy work apart from on the tape. Nick Riewoldt may well be among them, but I think they can tell his genius if they watch today. I never saw Bradman bat, but I knew he'd go all right, and I think history will be the same and judge Graham Kennedy very, very well.
And Graham Kennedy probably would have been quite chuffed to know that St Kilda players were his pallbearers today.
He loved the St Kilda footy side. That was the great thing about that entire service, was the warmth that came through, the love that came through, plus the reality, John Mangos, perhaps Graham Kennedy didn't love himself as much as the country did.
And it's very interesting to hear that, particularly Graham Blundell, his biographer, saying that the clown was stage managed by a sophisticated, lonely man. So a lot of sadness today, I suppose, associated with the Graham Kennedy that none of us as viewers knew.
No, exactly right. He was an amazing person, not only that timing and that natural talent, but the work ethic, which I think came through as well. He's this kind of performer who... he worked so hard at what he did, which what you have to do to become a genius.
We saw lots of his friends and family today. The John Paul Young sang a fabulous rendition of
Beautiful version of Love Is In The Air. And Daryl Summers there, of course, who worked around the time as a young man came through in Channel 9 and very much was in love with what Graham Kennedy was doing. I also love the fact that Graham Kennedy... he was so big on words, the whole section about the dictionary, wanting to get the dictionary out, and I think that's terrifically. I hope now that he goes irrumpantly through those plastic pearly gates.
Where did you pull that one out?
Well, I've got a few up the sleeve.
Must have been a very difficult day for Nolan Brown too. Of course, he'd been caring for him with her husband, Tony Sadler.
Nolan Brown and Tony Sadler were incredibly important parts of his life, not just in the latter years, but when they were young friends and worked together, colleagues, both writing and performing on stage and on television together, and certainly as carers and friends, they, as it came through today, amazing people.
All right, well, as his friends and carers head to Graham's favourite restaurant in Bowral, that brings to an end Seven's coverage of Graham Kennedy's funeral. Of course, Tony Squires, thank you very much for joining us.
My pleasure.
And we're going to leave you with shots of Graham as the coffin came out of the church, out of the Playhouse Theatre, sorry, not so long ago. They farewelled the King of Australian Television with a true showbiz affair in Mittagong. We'll have more details on the funeral, of course, in 7 News tonight at 6.
Tonight, Jen's handing over the Miss Universe crown, a 7 exclusive. Then All Saints at the special time of 9:30 tonight on 7.
Delayed reaction.
It was one of the worst pieces of acting you've ever seen on a football field. But anyway, he's got a free kick.
It's an important one. He's a good kick. Well, but he's hooked it.
Maybe there's a bit of justice.
I think most people will say that's a fair result.
Here we go, the delayed reaction.
Oh. Gee, there's not many players around this kick in. You can see the little huddle. And Smith's has come from half forward.
Taking a really good mark too. Looks for Petrie. Couldn't get there in time. Hargrave did well. Skipper. Back to Hargrave. Tumbles one inside 50. There's a couple of dogs. Is there a push? It is.
Umpire in perfect position.
A free kick to the Roos. Makepeace runs up the corridor. Good kick. He finds Colbert.
I reckon Lee Colbert would love playing across the half-forward line for once in his life.
Stevens with that lovely long kick of his, but Harris this time out points rocker. Did it well. And the Bulldogs just looking a little more composed now. Paul Hale makes Ryan Hargrave pay, and the Bulldog fans don't like
it. Gee, it's set up there for them, tucked into that ball.
It was a terrible one to sit under. That's what you call a hospital kick.
It's about 10 minutes, it seems.
He stood his ground, though. He's having a terrific game, is Ryan Hargrave. Disposal number 15.
Skipper, Smith, McMahon. Not much to go to there. Thompson and Grant in the back half of the ground for the Kangaroos. Grant in familiar territory up forward. Now, he's not doing anything to get that out, although I don't know whether umpire head could actually see what we could see.
And there's Hargrave waiting. Bulldogs have moved Brad Johnson to full forward.
Sinclair, quick kick. It's effective. To the Docklands wing, Colbert. To Thompson. Oh, he's run down on his backside. Still managed to get the handball away to Colbert, who looks for another big fella in Rocker. He soccers off the ground, and it's a free kick to the Dogs.
And it was marked, believe it or not, by Rowan Connolly, who writes for The Age.
And who couldn't resist showing it to the press box or the radio box.
He waved it to the crowd.
His first stat of the season, I think.
It was an uncontested possession too.
Well, that's a shank from McMahon. Stays in play. And then he went about 30 metres to kick too.
There's Brad Johnson, who's been moved back into the forward line. Every time he went to somebody in the Kangaroos forward line, when he went into the back line, they just kept on dragging him out of the action. Rodney Eaves decided, well, he's too important to be not in the thick of it, so let's put him back into the forward line.
There's a jumper hold, a Kangaroo free kick to Hale.
His jumper.
Who's been very influential. In the last 5 minutes of the opening half, Harvey making heavy weather of that, but in the end able to get it off to Jones, who hasn't had a lot of the footy thus far. He has a lovely left foot kick and he sits that up for Wells, but it hasn't been his night either, as yet at least. McMahon off to Gilby, Eagleton. Bulldogs stringing it together better now. Not so good, but it has just been superb.
Dangerous kick coming out of the Bulldogs' half back line to put it in the middle corridor to a contest situation. That is poor football by Hargrave.
Rocker lets it go from a long way. It is a mighty roost. A sausage roll to the big serve. His third. A stake through the heart of the Rocker.
Well, a wonderful kick by Saverio. And he didn't take too long thinking about that one, did he? He just decided, I'll go back and I'll run in and I'll kick it as long as I can. And he made sweet contact, but gee. Ryan Hargrave put that ball in a very, very risky situation when he came off the half-back line. And it cost his team a goal.
Ruse by 16. West. He misses the target. Walsh is there. Was that intentional from Brown? He's got away with another one. First gamer.
And this is Hargrave just a minute earlier. You can see back flank position. Should have kept it near the boundary line. And to put it into that central corridor towards Glenn Archer, well, you're going to pay the ultimate, which he did.
And young Cameron White has also won for a run in his first game. Contested that ruck knockout. The Kangaroos win the ball.
Yes!
Harding puts it inside 50. Dogs have got the numbers at the fall of the ball. One of them is Gilby. Over to Power. Now Boyd. Long kick. Leads provided by Eagleton. Archer's there to pick him off.
And Kangaroo supporters just get on their feet to applaud their hero. He's had 8 disposals in this second quarter and the ball just doesn't get behind him.
So it's White again against Hale. Hale comfortably. Clever tap to Simpson. To Harvey. Beautifully worked by the Ruse. Harvey, the little give and go to Harding, but Harding's going to go himself. He has a couple of bounces. Now draws Lansbury, who flies. I think it was a one-hander.
Lovely long kick to a two-on-two. All of them medium-sized players. And you can just see Lindsay Gilby didn't jump and punch. Lindsay Gilby, that's his opponent. That's his opponent. He's the last man there, Gilby, and he decides not to give a contest. He had to come over the top and get a fist on that.
And it was a one-hander, and he finishes off his work with a point. That's a disappointing result. Great mark, poor kick, and he knows it.
So, Tim.
So, 17 points the difference. Just over 2 minutes left. And the Bulldogs could do with one before half-time. Smith, Boyd. Cross. A rare kick. West with the sit here on Simpson. Now he spoiled Simpson. Completed what he claimed was a mark, not paid. Chris Grant, exasperated. Glenn Archer just having a great night.
And he's worked his way through four different opponents. Hahn, Robbins, Cooney, and now he's on Eagleton.
Simply tackled hard by Young White.
Careful, Tim. Let him go back, Boydie. Come round, Adam. Thank you. That's it, Boydie.
Jess Sinclair coming in for his 11th touch. He's averaging 21 this season.
One metre.
Playing a real sweeping role. Didn't have a great week last week, but doing the job tonight. Petrie.
Ryan, let him go back. 2 metres, Ryan. Thank you.
Repeatedly kick it out to leading players, the Kangaroos, and they've done it very well.
Sinclair, the big wind-up here, changed his mind. Now he's run himself into trouble. Back to Petrie, who kicks from a standing start. It's inside 50. Back of the pack is Gilby. He has support. Now here's the switch as the Bulldogs go out wide.
White's first disposal.
And it's a good one to Smith. They've got a couple of loose players here. The Dogs on the overlap. Power to Boyd. Can he use it? He decides to handball to Walsh. It was a poor decision. Archer again. Hacks it off the ground. Almost came off. But just taking the mark in the nick of time was Power.
Just not getting their disposal pinpoint. Now West. Few seconds left. Can they squeeze something out of it? Cross. Has to kick again. Getting awfully close to half-time. Robbins. Oh, that was ambitious, but Johnson makes it.
Did it well, Tim, didn't he? He did it well. Robbins has been playing it full forward. A very small Bulldog forward line, as we keep on saying, but that was good play. They moved it quickly onto his left boot, and that is a well-taken mark by Johnson.
So the siren is gone, and the skipper, the acting skipper in Luke Darcy's absence, and that will be for the remainder of this season, has a very important kick to take here to cut the margin from 17 to 11. And he does it beautifully. Oh, will he get another kick? Can he get another kick for that?
Oh, this is nasty. This is potentially very nasty. It's on off the ball too. This is potentially very nasty as players from all parts of the ground swarm.
And unfortunately, the umpires can't bounce the ball or play it on because the quarter's over.
They can, though, pay a free kick, I think, Rob, in those circumstances.
Well, there's officials everywhere, there's coaches everywhere. Laidley's there. Eads walking away, and this is still potentially pretty nasty.
What happened to Brad Johnson? Because I was marking the goals.
I wasn't looking either.
Did you see it, Tim?
Well, as he veered inboard, I think, just to go and greet his teammates, or be greeted by them, and he was collected by an opponent.
Well, you have to say, here we go. Here's a replay. And no free kick in that, so good umpiring.
Good umpiring, and Rowan Smith and Brad Johnson, Academy Award jobs in the first half.
We're going to take a break from the Dome, and it's the Dogs going to the break with the momentum. 57 plays, 46. It's the Roos leading by 11 points.
This season on Fox Footy Channel, good things come in fours.
Oh, you've got to be on the Blues now!
It's going and going and going! Rocker's kicked it!
What a goal!
Top of the year!
Classic Quarters, Monday on Fox Footy Channel.
He's coming back! Not too many men could go 57 rounds with the catalogue man.
He's immense.
He's
sure tests a man's ability to stay true. Dougie McKenna could end this right now. All he has to do is take a sip of that average bourbon.
That ain't your dream. That ain't your dream.
You've ever seen anything quite like this?
Go Harvey Norman for massive cashbacks on reverse cycle split system air conditioners. Receive up to $300 cashback for a limited time. This Mitsubishi 8-kilowatt split system is yours for a low $1,499 after cashback. We have a huge range of famous brands, so hurry in and find the model you need at a price you can afford. Reverse cycle air conditioning is efficient and economical for winter warmth. Up to $300 cashback on reverse cycle split system air conditioning now at Harvey Norman.
Get rhythm when you get the blues. Get rhythm when you get the blues. Get rhythm when you get the blues. Get rhythm.
Whether it's a garden shed, the home of your dreams, or even the MCG, Brighter Builders are using products made from BlueScope steel materials like Colorbond and Zincaloom steel. BlueScope steel, brighter building.
To notch up 500 goals. In he comes, the captain of Melbourne. Goal number 500 to David Neates.
We're here in Melbourne to relive a classic footy moment that has it all.
And who else could give us all this?
Who else but the maestro? Hey, James Hurd.
Hey, guys.
All right, so it's Essendon 131, West Coast 131. 30 minutes and 48 seconds gone.
In the umpire has a ball up and it's on.
He's got it.
Hey, maybe Murphy should have kicked it. I'm not the umpire, I'm Bully. Bully gets it after Hurd. Wake, the fairy tale's complete. James Hurd, you are a champion.
Yes.
Give him a hug.
Weeknights on The Fever, footy's only talkback TV show. We debate all the day's hot topics, talk to the game's biggest names.
There are big problems down there at Collingwood.
And of course, you can have your say.
White Line Fever, weeknights 7:30 Eastern on Fox Footy Channel.
Welcome back to the Telstra Dome, where the Kangaroos lead by 11 points. A scoreline that Rodney wouldn't be too unhappy with. You're well and truly still in it. What was your message to the team?
Oh yeah, they got a bit of a burst to start with. Because really we've played very poorly. We've played extremely poorly. We've been outplayed in most areas, especially in stoppages. But after we got that off the liver, we spoke about that. No, we're only a goal down or 10 points down, whatever it is, and the fact we know that we're right in it. So we start to play, we have a lift of intensity. Hopefully we're 10 or 15%, we can get, we can pinch this game.
Who do you see as your biggest worry from the Roos in this second half?
I think they've rotated pretty well in the middle. Obviously, Grant and Harvey are probably the ones that are carrying the footy at this stage, so they're the ones we're looking at.
Well, thanks for joining us. Good luck for the second half. And just confirming that Ryan Hargrave has been reported for a first quarter incident with Shannon Grant. Quarters.
Thanks, Christy. So it's been a big night for Ryan Hargrave. That's the incident that we'll see him in the books. And I'm not sure whether he'll cop a plea on that one or go to the tribunal.
Yes, I don't think it was of great
consequence.
No. And that is one of the criteria that has to be dealt
with. Watch your heels.
Matthew Boyd starting on the wing on Daniel Wells. Wells just the four disposals in the first half.
Who can make the early running? Take away for the Bulldogs. Cooney to cross to West. And now the spillage. And Big Hale has got himself into those contests frequently. This is Boyd. High tackle, so it's a Bulldog free kick.
Tackle slipped up.
How did you assess Rodney Eade's comments, Rob, who pretty would have been reasonably happy with just the 11-point margin?
Well, he obviously believes they haven't played well and is concerned about winning the clearances. The Kangaroos have dominated the stoppages, but Bulldogs got this first one.
And a good lead from Murphy, despite the efforts of the Kangaroo defence to close in on him. He was able to mark it, but he's going to be kicking from outside 50.
And the
Rodney Eaters persisted with Tim Walsh, the young fella on debut at centre-half forward. Now he's struggling to get into the game. He's been on and off the ground. There's the tall fella there. But good to see that the coach has given him another chance to have a crack at it to start this third quarter.
So to string two together, but he won't with that. It's well wide. And Glenn Archer has been the dominant player on the ground. He's been magnificent back there. And he has just covered the back half of the ground with all the menace of a cruising battleship.
And his kick falls slightly short. No mark. Almost grabbed by Boyd. Cooney, good handball. Back to Boyd. Here's a chance for Gian Siracusa. And he kicks the goal. First one to the Dogs. Points the difference.
Cooney at ground level gets it and quickly spears that handball forward to Boyd, in turn to Gian Siracusa, and they've been very sharp with their hands to set up a player in space.
Team's in front, but he'd be worried, Dean Laidley. Bulldogs within 5 points. Don't necessarily deserve to be there, but they're there. It's wide open. Cooney's looking dangerous. Skipper just working it on. Murphy, Gian Siracusa. Boyd there with him as well. Wasn't expecting that, but was held when he didn't have it. And he has the chance to put the Dogs in front.
Well, he's been in the thick of the action, has Boyd, in this third quarter. We're only 3 minutes into it, but he's been on the wing on Daniel Wells.
Dirty night for Wells so far.
It is, and you'd expect him to pick it up, Tim, but the handball of the Bulldogs, 86-62, starting to take effect.
Fading for a behind. They trail by 4 points. Well, they were the best part of 3 goals down seconds before half-time, and they had the chance to be in front, a minute 20 into the third quarter.
And Kangaroos going with the huddle, and again, the breakout into space, and Daniel Wells the target again.
And he gets it.
Let him up! Thanks!
Well, I guess if they create space quarters, the man who can get into it quicker than anyone else is Daniel Wells.
That's his fifth disposal for the night, and he finds Thompson. He's off. Pumps it long. Rocker from a long way back attacks the ball. And he is in pretty good nick tonight, is Big Sav. Just attacked the ball from deep in the pocket. Never looked like missing it.
Rodney Eade would be disappointed. He'd be disappointed that after the Wells mark, he'd probably be even thinking, well, Wells shouldn't have marked it, Boyd should have been onto him to get a spoil. But the Wells kick was marked on the wing by Thompson. Chris Grant couldn't get there to get the spoil on, and then the Thompson kick into the forward 50, and Brian Harris, the defender, couldn't get there to get a spoil on. It wasn't as if they were bullet-like passes.
Rockers kick 3 from about 52 out. So his haul tonight, Sav Rocker, is 3 goals, 3.
Work out, runner! Out, runner!
And the Kangaroos are setting up a zone defence. They're not going man on man, so there should be a bit of space there for Gilby. But usually when a zone defence is set up, you can get the short kick away like that.
Well, now Smith's shaped to go other than over the mark, which is normally called as play on, but he was given leeway there. Cross to McMahon. And the Bulldogs work it out nicely. Skipper West. Quiet first half, has Murphy loose. And within range.
Well, Robert Murphy just has to kick this goal, because the shot he had earlier in this quarter was a pretty ordinary one for a very skillful player. started his career on the wing and then spent the next few years playing half-back flank. It's time he came of age as a quality finishing forward.
Taking the long approach. And he's missed again. Clear. So, misses at both ends of the ground. And the Bulldogs continue to trail by a handful of points.
And again, you can see the huddle, the early break.
Wells is the kicker. Gives it a bit of air. And not a good result for the Roos.
Stevens in picture is playing on Robert Murphy at the moment.
It's Hale on the phone, or the headphones at least.
Don't block arms! Jump up!
50 out. A goal here would put the Dogs in front. Skip of the tap to Murphy, and he can do just that.
Maybe he likes them on the run.
Clear hold in there, not spotted by the umpire. Big hold, the jumper well away from Drew Petrie's body.
Well, just dominated play, in this third quarter. And Bulldogs have had 11 handballs in this third term. The Kangaroos haven't had any. In fact, the Kangaroos have just had the four disposals, and we are 8 minutes in.
Important for the Kangaroos to win the centre break here and to just stem the flow. Wells placing that and placing it well for Harding. This is Smith, the first game up, well tackled and turning it over. McMahon, Power, Gilby. Bulldogs starting to play with some confidence. Gian Siracusa has Boyd lurking down the dockside wing. Cooney inside, but he goes straight for. And he delivers to the other first gamer in Cameron White. Walsh, rather.
Well, I think, Tim, this will be his first kick in league football. And his father, of course, is CEO for the Kangaroos. So how would he be feeling at this stage?
What would he be wanting, I wonder?
Oh, you'd have to want your son to kick a goal with his first kick in league football.
Mixed emotions. He hasn't... Was it touched? It might have carried home. It has. The Dogs lead by eight. And he joins the select, not so few, who have kicked a goal with their first kick in the big time.
Including R. Walls, Carlton.
1967.
It was a long time ago.
That is something he will never forget. A little bit of luck on his side.
A lot of luck.
That doesn't matter. It'll go in the scorebook as a goal, and what a great reaction from his teammates.
Well, a man named nicknamed Woosher has kicked the goal, and boy oh boy, it's 8 points now in favour of the Dogs, and you sense some real trouble for the Roos as they force it forward again. Harris dispossessed, no holding the man, says the umpire. So Harris has got the free for the Kangas. To Harvey, out wide to Sinclair, to Archer, who's had a wonderful night. Bangs it long and high, Grant's underneath it. Strong.
And goes for McMahon, who's given us some pretty good run off half back. And he's burning the grass right now. It's all come together for the Dogs. Murphy now. The 50's open, and Johnson with strong hands in front of Sinclair.
And that is the great strength of Brad Johnson. That is a really strong overhead mark attacking the football from a medium-sized player. And he's on a medium-sized opponent, and that's where he's got the great advantage. Johnson needs a taller opponent when he plays
deep in the forward line for the Bulldogs because he's so good overhead, and Jess Sinclair really can't go with him.
Very similar shot to the one he nailed right on half-time, and he's done it again. The Dogs lead by 14. He's their leading goal kicker for the season, Brad Johnson.
Murphy's certainly come into it in this quarter, Tim. Kicked a goal, a couple of behinds, and set Brad Johnson up there.
Well, the acid's really on the ruse now. Worries for Dean Laidley. They're being opened up the ruse in this third term.
You can see Archer has been moved on to Murphy, and Glenn Archer's got to be thinking, what more do I have to do? Like, he's their leading possession getter, their inspiration. Some of these younger Kangaroos have to lift.
Dogs have kicked the last five. Here's a chance for the Kangas. Good pass by Harvey to Grant, and this is a must-kick goal.
And the old school, Harvey to Shannon Grant.
Grant's kicked two tonight. 15 for the year. 15 goals, 8 to be precise. Now he's on a very slight angle, kicking from 45. As I said, a must-kick goal just to stem the flow here. And he makes no mistake. Ruse get one back. One in each quarter to Shannon Grant. And the margin is back to 8 points in favour of the Dogs.
Good kick to the advantage side. Made it very hard for Daniel Cross to be able to get there to get a fist on it. Daniel Wells has been moved out of the midfield. He has really struggled tonight, and Rowan Smith has been moved onto him. Smith played most of the first half as a forward, but we know, of course, he can play in the back line.
Clearwinder skipper, covered by Harris. Stevens overrunning it. Harris back for a second go. There's a free kick to Eagleton. Johnson circling. Murphy going wide.
Clever.
And here's Walsh again. Oh, he dropped it. A nervous miss. He's been paid.
He's having a bit of luck, isn't he?
He is having a bit of luck. I don't think he'll kick a goal from there. Man on the mark at 50. He kicks ambitiously. Make peace in the way. He's obviously very nervous. He didn't centre the kick that produced the goal, and he dropped that mark, and then that kick wasn't the greatest placement. Make peace, good ball. Dogs, though, with Crummers. Corey Jones gets into it. Sinclair. That one hung and gave Gilby a crack at it, and he whisks it away and delivers well to Boyd.
Boyd chips over the top to Cooney. Good mark. Stood his ground against Make Peace.
That's it.
Now, where are the leads going to come from?
Move it on! Play on!
Told to play on. He goes looking for Johnson. He's going to outmark two of them and can't do so. Rawlings. To Petrie. And he finds Thompson at halfback.
Got away from Chris Grant again. Chris Grant, when they go on the long leads, Chris Grant really struggles to keep up. So he's zoned back.
Nathan Thompson, and he's kicked it to his direct opponent, Grant. Couldn't take the mark. Gian Siracusa, quickly to Harris. Now Hargrave, disposal number 17. And the mark has been paid to Hale.
Just had enough of it. Stevens, boy, they've gone from the wing to full back. Rawlings. There's not much standing in his way. He draws the one tackler and gives to Brown. That's not great. So the Bulldogs have reversed their fortunes in the first half of this third term, coming from 11 points down to lead by 8. And Dean Laidley has some thinking to do. Ferrito, third man in line there. Cross, little hand pass. Harris in the midst of it, and there'll be a ball up.
Little game of cat and mouse here. Chris Grant on Nathan Thompson. You can see Nathan Thompson. Chris Grant has decided, well, I'll go up to full forward for the Bulldogs, and you better come and chase me. And that's a little win to the Bulldogs.
Eagleton. Clever kick to Power, who knocks it on further to Murphy. Murphy keeps the ball alive. Running onto it is Gian Siracusa. He's over the ball. It's got to be a free kick, surely, to the Roos. Dragged it back in. Very lucky not to be penalised. And another bounce.
And Chris Grant still up there in the goal square for the Bulldogs.
So 60 out from the Dogs' goal. Ferrito almost a throw. McMahon, good handball to Murphy. Now chance as he weighs up his options. Decides to go long. Grant wrestles with Thompson. Grant wins the battle and kicks the goal. What a win for the Dogs. You'll be very happy with that, Robert Walls.
Well, he just decided about 90 seconds ago. Thompson's taken a couple of marks on him by leading out to the wings. And when the ball was on the opposite side of the ground, Chris Grant said, well, I'm going to go down to the forward line and see if Thompson will follow me. Now, Thompson followed him. Had Thompson stayed back and even run to the other end, I reckon Chris Grant, who's playing as a defender, would have said, well, I better get back on him. So he won the war of wills and rubbed salt into the wounds by kicking the goal. And, of course, Chris Grant now is back at centre-half back on Nathan Thompson.
His 501st career goal. Dean Laidley watching his team outscored 5-1 in this quarter. Ferrito bangs them forward. Long kick can Wells. He can't get into the aerial contest. And Grant Swan was clean enough to take it to the line.
This is such an important game for the Kangaroos. They started in a blaze of glory this season. They won their first 5 games. They lost the 2 that they played in Adelaide against the Crows and Port Power. They can't afford to drop 3 in a row because, as we said pre-game, they go down to Geelong next week. That'll be tough at Skilled Stadium. And then after that, they're up at the Gabba. Now, last year, they started their season particularly well. And then they fell in a big hole. They won their first 3 games last year, and then they lost 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of the next 7.
McMahon, clearing kick back into the middle. The race is on. Jones will get there first. Over to Ferrito. Well done by Dale Morris.
That was good defensive work. Double-handed fist. Good as a kick. And not to be penalised by doing that either. Very well done.
Western Bulldogs have not won 2 in a row since 2002.
When Terry Wallace was coach.
Round 17, 18.
Clap!
That's a free kick to Simpson, is it? No, umpire let it go.
Should have been.
Is that a free kick? It is to Ferrito. Dogs by 14 points. Kangaroos have led 55 minutes of this game. It's Ferrito. Kicks it long. Hales there, so is Thompson. Front and centre is McMahon.
little give to Johnson. Back into the middle. And it's marked by Walsh.
Well, he's getting a bit of it. Gives it back to Johnson. Having a run now. Now Eagleton. Archer holds him up. Cagely played by Archer. Now Power. Just beyond range. But with two men on the lead.
Set it up well, didn't they? They set it up well. Little chip passes, short kicks to teammates. And they are just dominating the marks in this game. Close to 100, the Western Bulldogs, with their little chip passes. 73 to the Kangaroos.
This will be Murphy's ninth disposal of the quarter.
It's been wonderful for them, Tim. Last week against Brisbane at half forward, and again tonight. Just needs to kick accurately from the set shots.
And he does, and he puts them 20 points in front. Six goals to one in this third quarter, the Bulldogs' way. Two of them to Robert Murphy.
Two to Murphy. 20-point buffer to the Western Bulldogs. 22 and a half have ticked over in this third term. Eagleton, Simpson.
Thanks, guys.
In this game for the Roos, 17 disposals to Archer, 17 to Harvey, 15 to Simpson. Oh, for the Bulldogs, 17 to Hargrave, 16 each to McMahon and Power.
Daniel Harris and Daniel Wells really have to lift, because they are struggling. They have to get plenty of the ball for the Roos to have an impact, and at the moment they're just accepting their lot.
Clever inside-out kick by Hale. Finds Harvey. 60 from goal into the pocket. Thompson. That was really clever from Hale.
That's it.
So Nathan Thompson.
Brian Harris has moved on to Thompson. And Chris Grant is back with Severio.
1-1 to Thompson tonight. 10 goals, 3 for the season. Twice the leading goal scorer for the Hawks. Now Aru. And that's a point.
So the margin 19 in the last 5 minutes of the term. Hargrave, big possession early, just dallied, and that was a great effort by Harvey. Harris helping him, getting it back to him, and Petrie now can line them up.
Brilliant effort by Brent Harvey, and I'm sure we'll have a look at it, but he's put the smother on, and then he took a... Have a look at the smother. And he just wound up. He can make mistakes, young Hargrave. He's got to learn to lift the kick there, and then the reflex take there. And then to set it up. Wonderful play by the little fella.
Big kick this. Kangaroos 19 points down, and Petrie doesn't score. Didn't even make the distance. And White gives it to Gilbey. The Bulldogs are playing confident footy. Not a bad positioning of the ball, but Sinclair committing himself to it ahead of Boyd. Rocker gives it back to him. Not much option there, but just to tunnel it. Good tackle on White. Sinclair, a third play, gives him a real chance. Brown, great tackle, Gilbey, and well done by the Dogs. Harris taking it through.
That was good footy, wasn't it?
Pressure footy, wasn't it? They just kept charging the Kangaroos.
Great tackle.
Good tackle by the much smaller Lindsay Gilbey on Leroy Brown. And Brian Harris said, I've had enough of this, I'll swat it through for a behind.
Short kick finds Harris.
Rodney Eade would be really disappointed if his Bulldogs gave up a goal in the last 3 minutes of this quarter.
So halfback Ruse have the numbers, and that's Makepeace in front. No, not paid. And here come the Dogs on the break. Handball over to Power. Draws the player, gets it to Grant. Blind turns out of trouble. And the old timer goes to the end. Vintage Chris Grant. What a ripper. The blind turn to boot. And there's life in the old legs, yes.
And that's the second goal for the quarter to the centre half back.
And I reckon his instincts as a forward of days of yore served him pretty well there.
Oh, he did that well, didn't he, to spin out of trouble, accelerate as quick as he possibly could.
And that's the Kangaroos supporters' reaction.
Oh, devastation. And there's Chris Grant, right back at fullback on Lee Brown. So he's kicked one goal on Brown and one on Nathan Thompson.
Dogs by 24. Should be a Kangaroos takeaway. Harris took a long time, but delivered well to Wells. They need something from him. They need some spark.
Move it on!
They have target forwards, but they also have a flooded 50 to deal with. Sinclair to Stevens, a long kick of the ball, and he probes here. Oh, beautifully done, Shannon Grant.
That is a 60-metre pass. He meant that. Michael Stevens, he is a wonderful kick, and he put that out to the advantage side of Shannon Grant. A little bit of a nudge on his opponent. And that is a half-forward opportunist at his best.
Gee, you can see why Anthony Stevens played the way he did. He had to make sure his little brother never got the ball in the backyard.
Well, this is a huge kick. Just have to put this one through. It has been a seven-goal quarter to the Bulldogs. And just the one to the Kangaroos.
He's a true boot, Shannon Grant. He kicks his fourth, and he keeps the Roos afloat. Four goals, one to Grant.
Back-to-back goals for Grant.
Yes.
At either end of the ground. More grants than in Peter Costello's budget.
Well, that's the goal the Roos so desperately needed.
They've got an extra man in defence, the Bulldogs. Rodney Eade wanting to maintain this lead.
And here they come again. Ferrito pumps it long, deep into attack. Big pack fly. Lurking down is McMahon. Oh, it's a dodgy handball. Attacking it is Petrie. Keeps it alive. There's Brown. Harvey! Misses. Oof. In fact, it's on the full. Gee,
that was a behind.
That was like a behind.
Certainly looked like it on that camera shot.
Yeah, it did, didn't it? We had a great angle from here.
Rowan Smith. Now Hahn. I hope it's not a one-kick game at the end of the night. Gian Siracusa. Not long left. We're in the last minute. Big play here either way. And it's going to restart on the Bulldogs side of the wing. Now let's get a look at it. That's inconclusive. That indicates the call might have been right. We, from where we were right behind the kick, and it looked to be a behind.
Daniel Pratt's been moved on to Robert Murphy. Murphy having 9 disposals and 4 marks in this third quarter. Just a bit too quick for Glenn Archer.
Michael Stevens makes the takeaway, but the Bulldogs are still a chance here. And that was pretty well done by Gilby. 2 goes at it. Archer needed to make the spoil. Sinclair. Time for the Rouge yet off halfback. Harvey and Wells. They've got 20 seconds to make something of it. That's a pretty good ball from Wells for Grant. Couple against him. Hale been very good. Releases Grant now. But Brad Johnson, at the other end of the ground from which he's exerted most influence, does well and makes the final play of the third quarter as he did in the second. And the Bulldogs have had a great turn. They kick 7-2. And at the last change, they lead by 18 points.
Just moved the ball so quickly, didn't they? They had Robert Murphy alive and dangerous up on that half-forward line, and Chris Grant, the man in picture, who was able to kick 2 goals from centre-half back with some adventurous play.
Coming up on Tuesday, the toughest of all St Kilda wingmen, Bob.
Well, it's got to be Jeffrey Chopper Cunningham.
Plus a man who just kept on punching.
Oh, Scotty Palmer from the Herald Sun.
Grumpy Old Man, Tuesday on Fox Footy Channel.
I love a laugh. The Simpsons, Seinfeld, Will and Grace. I can't get enough of them. But it doesn't mean I rule my life by them. If I have some pressing engagements or I just want to drop in on a friend, I know my shows will be repeated 2 hours later on a second channel.
With a variety of extra time shift channels, ensuring you have twice as much chance of seeing your favourite shows, it's the choice you've come to enjoy, plus greater convenience. That's what makes digital simply better. Call today to upgrade.
As your team goes through its final preparations for the weekend's matchup, let Fox Footy remind you what happened last time the sides collided. Footy is all about passion and history. Relive the passion. Thursdays and Fridays on Last Time They Met.
What can they do? What changes do they need to ring?
Well, you might even look at Archer and just say, well, let's put him across the half forward line. Now, Archer's been wonderful for them, but Robert Murphy's just had too much acceleration for him. So maybe you put Archer towards centre-half forward, and he just knocks a few blokes over. You know he'll go for his marks. If he can get a couple of goals, he might just inspire the others. But again, it's a bit of a shame that you've got to rely on the old stalwarts to do it.
There's Rodney. Let's have a look at that Brent Harvey kick that was ruled out on the full. We had a great shot angle of it up here. It looked like a point to us. Here's the kick.
Gee, looks dead set from there. Was never outside the behind post on that angle.
Well, let's hope it's not a one-point ball game.
Let's
go to Christy Mulhouse.
Thanks, Stephen. Well, Rodney Eade told his team last week to run Brisbane ragged, and they did just that. You'd think that he would have said the same thing for this last quarter against the Kangaroos, who have just been interstate 2 weeks in a row, and the Bulldogs certainly do look the fresher team. A few of the Kangaroos players getting their legs worked on in that huddle, but we do know that the Kangaroos like to work. They work best under pressure, their backs to the wall. So will it be the heart or the legs that win out in the last term?
That's a very interesting stat there, that the leading Bulldog disposals, Hargrave, McMahon, Power and Gilbey, the top four are all playing in the back line for the Bulldogs and all have been encouraged by their coach to run, carry and share. And this is a change from the Bulldogs of old. The younger fellas given every opportunity to make the play.
We start the final term and it is the Bulldogs leading by 3 goals. Skipper, stripped of the ball. Kangaroos on the attack. Can they get it out? Eventually, a little kick by Simpson back into the middle. Hale over the ball, tapped it forward to Rawlings. Now Ferrito kicks loose off the side of the boot. Colbert's there. You got a bad bounce. Hargrave. Little give to McMahon. Over to Morris. He's tackled well by Ferrito. Umpire lets it go. Wells, good hard ball get by West, but he gave the handball straight to Harvey. Harvey to Colbert. Inside 50, Grant's there to mop up.
Well, they've got Colbert at half forward, and big scenario on the bench.
Cooney, still with plenty of run in those young legs. Keeps it wide for Rowan Smith, with Jess Smith losing his footing, and he's drilled it to Murphy. Now the range will test him here, so he doesn't go for it. He goes for Johnson. His perpetual motion up there, but he's on the impossible angle.
Jess Sinclair's playing on Brad Johnson, and that is a real worry. As we saw in the third quarter, he will struggle to go with Johnson in the air.
Now he's a long way out to be trying to bend it back, so he's toyed with the idea of the drop punt. Look for the inward pass. He's having a shot. Almost impossible, you would think, from there. And it's a behind. What a chance this is for the Bulldogs. Win tonight, they are 4-4. They're level with St Kilda. They're on the edge of the eight, approaching the middle stages of the season.
Makepeace finds Jones. Don't write off the Roos just yet. They've got great ticker. Hargrave. Fed it out to Boyd. Inside 50 they go again.
Another brilliant pass by Lindsay Gilbey. And Gian Siracusa. Well, he didn't have to work too hard to get it, did he? But Boyd setting up the handball that eventually sets Gilbey up, who is one of the best kicks in the competition. And if this one goes through, very hard to see the Kangas coming back.
Gian Siracusa's kick two. He's at 7 goals, 7 for the year. This should be a six-pointer. Well, the all-important first goal of the final term goes the Bulldogs' way. And the margin blows out to 25. Now it's going to be tough for the Roos.
Shapes as a disheartening night for Dean Laidley.
It does, and Saverio Rocca started this final quarter on the interchange bench. He's kicked 3 goals of their 10. Shannon Grant's kicked 4. Not only is Sav there, so too is Petrie.
Big takeaway to cross. Stevens just getting a hand in there, otherwise Gian Siracusa could have been lining them up again. And it's going to come back because Power's got it.
Best game I've seen Sam Power play.
Cross starting to win some footy. McMahon, Bulldogs with confidence and authority.
Glenn Archer can't go with Murphy.
And on the lead and getting it between the eyes, Gian Siracusa will line them up now.
And Glenn Archer cannot go with Robert Murphy because Murphy's just got too much leg speed. And Dean Laidley's got to make a move because he's champion warrior. Doesn't deserve to be playing on a bloke who's just got that much speed.
Goal here, and they might just about have iced the Kangaroos, but it's a long shot. He'll be kicking from 50. Right on the 50. And right on the money. The Dogs by 31.
And the last 2 goals have been set up from running half-backs with brilliant foot passing in Gilbey and McMahon.
It's been 9 goals to 2 since half-time. And the margin has blown out to 31 points in favour of the Bulldogs. Cooney. There's Archer. Harris. Simpson. To Rawlings. And his kick finds Harris on centre wing. In the middle is a box on in the middle. There's 2 Kangaroos and a Bulldog involved. Keep an eye on that as Power takes another mark inside 50.
It was Lee Brown putting a slammer under Wade Skipper.
West. Smith. Good effort by Stevens to spoil at the last second. And we'll have a throw in.
After the last goal, here's Rodney Eade in the Bulldogs coaching box. That's an unusual sight with 15 minutes left on the clock. He's feeling pretty good. In fact, they were about 16 minutes plus at that stage. Bit of footy left yet, but the Bulldogs are going well. Cross is kicked well, smothered by Makepeace.
And Saverio Rocca coming on now. Corey Jones going off.
With Rocket looking that confident, I've been pretty humble thus far quarters, but I might come out and just remind you that 5 minutes or so into the opening quarter, I tipped this.
Chris Grant's done his trick that he did in the third quarter. He's now run to full forward and Colbert's followed him.
Great mark by Simpson. Harris. Good result. Makepeace. Nothing working. Thompson. Archer. Has to fight here. Well tied up by Harris. A ball up is the correct decision. The Bulldogs want a ball. Bulldog fans at least.
Thanks, Glenn.
Well, perhaps strictly under the modern interpretation, given that he dived, he did leave himself open. The fans might be right that time. Here's Harris. Colbert. And that's a good kick for Grant.
Shannon Grant's kick 4. That's a beautiful pass. And Harvey just can't hang on to it. Oh, a lucky let off for the Dogs and they're away. West, Cooney. Good looking kick towards Macha. Just got there in the nick of time.
Did you detect the Cooney roar when he got that ball? We've got a new cult figure.
This crowd tonight, 32,901, is the biggest crowd for these two teams since back in 1999 at the MCG. So the fans of both sides have responded.
And the Bulldogs have made plenty of space between where this ball will be thrown in and the goal square. And they'll be hoping they might be able to get a knock towards that area for a forward to run onto it.
The jumper!
Hold the jumper. No, you had hold of his jumper.
It's against Skipper. It's going to Hale. And Hale's kick finds Rawlings. He hasn't had a lot of it tonight. This is disposal number 10.
Started on Brad Johnson, virtually playing at fullback.
Yep. Kick to half four, drops short, finds Harding. Harding wastes no time, looks for Rocca. But Harris is up to the task.
Harris is confident to back himself in marking contests on that last line of defence. Not many fullbacks are like that.
Good kick too, as he finds Boyd.
Skipper, not sure whether to come or go. Now it's a dangerous thing to do when you've got Daniel Wells against you. He will cut you to pieces, and he has done here. If only it'll sit, Harvey will kick a goal, and he does, and the Kangaroos are barely alive.
And Skipper's off.
He hit his knee, I think, Rob, when he lost his footing.
He did. He did, and this surface is slippery. As one AFL player said through the week, it is slimy.
He's not smiling now.
Couple of quick clearances, Kangaroos. It's like they've got Thompson in the ruck and put Hale to centre half forward.
And to add insult to injury for Skipper, hurt his knee, cost a goal and got the spray from the coach. He got the triple whammy.
He got the trifecta.
And they're not out of it yet, the Kangas.
They've got to get the next one, don't they? And quick.
Still lots of time left. It's a 25-point margin. Gian Siracusa kicked a couple of goals in the final term. Inside 50 go the Dogs. Robbins. Good run down. It's a free kick go to Jess Smith. It was an important tackle. He finds Rawlings. Over the top to Sinclair. Into the middle, Brown.
Now the Kangaroos build. Wells is on the lead. It's an ordinary kick though by Brown. Grant. Simpson. Into the pocket. Rocker from the side. Big Sam just couldn't hang on to it. And Grant concedes the point. Oh, it was all set up for the big fella.
The big fella set himself. He leapt. I don't know how high he got off the ground. We'll have a look at it here. Oh, yes, he's got the knee on the shoulder and just couldn't hang that half second that he needed.
I think Harris buckled underneath the weight.
He has taken under the ear, hasn't he, McMahon? Yes! Perfect delivery to Gian Siracusa.
Right there!
And Boyd, as the Dogs still look pretty confident. Gilby running into space, can afford the little fumble, and he has a man loose in Murphy. He can trot in and nail it from the angle, but he doesn't. Margin 25, but more than half the quarter is left.
Michael Stevens. The kick's got to be good. He's looking for Harris. Throw it on centre wing.
And young White, Cameron White, to do the ruck work.
Minson still sitting on the bench, not in shot there, Rob, but hasn't been used since early in the match.
It is interesting, Tim, that we haven't seen more of Minson. I wonder if he's carrying an injury. We've seen plenty of Skipper and Cameron White, who is a tall, skinny fella. You can see that up against Nathan Thompson.
Push out. That's got to be a free kick to the Roos, no doubt about that. It was against the first game of Cameron White. Thompson's got the kick and he goes short to Rawlings. No one on the mark, so he's off. Oh, lost it. Got it again. Pratt. Long kick. Rocker gets jostled out of the contest. Did well to keep his feet. And we'll have a bounce. 45 out from the Roos.
Minson has been brought on. There's Big Will. Have a look at the shoulders. As wide as an axe handle.
But he's not all brawn. He's got a bit of brain and I think speaks languages, doesn't he? And plays music or something. He's a bit of a multi-talent.
Plays the flute.
Oh, Hardy. Boy. That missed by a lot. He was trying to hook that perhaps to the hot spot or maybe even score. And it's gone out 30 metres around from the behind post. Gilby has linked things up pretty well back there tonight. Cross, yes! Smith, Gian Siracusa. Half the quarter gone now. He's played on. Dangerous. They're making the odd mistake. They've got to be careful here, the Dogs. Ferrito gives the Kangaroos a chance. And Harvey, although on the big angle.
Could be the second mistake that cost them a goal. And Gian Siracusa holding his head. Realises he absolutely blew that one.
Just careless. Well, there's our Kangaroo supporter. She is our barometer.
Don't go forward!
Harvey, tough shot, big kick, good kick, just fading. And it's still the Bulldogs by 24.
So once again, it's Lindsay Gilby to do the kicking in. Well, that's just a third pass.
Back around!
Thanks.
As he finds Morris.
Me!
Short to Johnson. Past the halfway mark now, the final term, as Johnson's kick finds West.
1 minute, Adam! Thank you!
Scott West, 17 touches tonight, averaging 28 this season, his leading disposal getter in the comp, so he's been kept reasonably quiet by his standards. You won't mind if they win. Smith to Johnson. To Boyd. Long kick. It's home, I think. It is. Great running play by the Bulldogs.
And Matthew Boyd has kicked a long goal from right on the paint on 50. To the left to right. That was good enough.
And it's typical of so many of the Bulldog goals, particularly in the second half, running in numbers, drawing an opponent, sharing the ball with a sideways handball, and then the accurate finish off. Seven up is something that the Bulldogs rarely have been plagued with inaccuracy over the years, but they're getting it right, and certainly with their set shots tonight, they've kicked 9 goals, 3 from set shots.
They have been scoring high, though. And for a team that doesn't have target forwards in the traditional sense. But here's Boucher. Harris. If you can. Thompson should nail this. And starts. The Kangaroos.
Just watch Kearney. And he just needed to keep the eyes on the football, over the football, and bash and crash it forward. He just couldn't let it free up.
They're just hanging in there, the Kangaroos. Still time. But it's a 4-goal buffer. Favour of the Dogs. Minson over the top. Taken away, though, by Harris. Here come the Kangaroos again. Long kick. Grant. Will he concede the point? Right.
Been terrific, Chris Grant.
To Boyd, to Cross. Well, he's kicked 502 goals in his career, Chris Grant. The last one wouldn't have dobbed any better than that. As we have a throw-in on centre wing.
Well, Daniel Cross is the master of the handball. He's had 14 handballs this evening.
One Chris Grant goal at this venue, which might rank a little higher. Match against Essendon back in 2000. Eagleton, defensive side. Shooting by the arm, so Eagleton just had to work it onto the boot. Did it well. Wells, oh. Kilby did well. Holds it up. Kangaroos pressing here. They've raised their intensity. Steal by Jones. He's had a quiet night.
Great work by Scott West to lock that ball in, and you can see his teammates appreciate. He tries to get a kick on this.
And he did. Which makes it a legitimate disposal. Good quick thinking. Cooney. Great acceleration, but a good tackle by Ferrito. Archer. Jones. Pratt giving it to Harvey. Kangaroos still trying, still coming. Grant, though, getting better as the night wears on.
Again, Chris Grant, rock solid in defence. And there's the new centre-half forward for the Bulldogs. It's Adam Cooney playing on Glenn Archer. Michael Stevens has moved on to Robert Murphy.
West, back of the pack. Fired it out to Gilby. He's away. Not a lot to give to. By hand in the end to Boyd. Out wide to G and Syracusa. He's kicked 4. Johnson. The face and sneaked home for a point.
David Hale has just taken himself off with cramp in his calf.
Sandy point?
Yep, 25. Puts them 5 shots in front. Hard for the Kangaroos to win from there in 6 1/4 minutes. Harvey's still running. Nathan Thompson kicked their last goal. He has 2 for the night.
They've got to kick 5 goals in.
It's a shock. It's understood the pop diva is staying strong, surrounded by loved ones as she prepares for the fight of her life.
The pop star's breast cancer is front page news. Kylie Minogue and her fight for life has reached every corner of the globe.
Kylie Minogue has been diagnosed with breast cancer.
Her website, Kylie.com, has been jammed by well-wishers. Fans and friends in Melbourne have delivered personal messages to her parents' Canterbury home. Friend David Woods has known Kylie since they were teenagers.
She'll be fine, I'm sure. She's the strongest girl I've ever met.
Minogue was diagnosed with a lump in her breast yesterday morning, but signs of ill health may have been evident for some weeks. She had been waiting for test results at her new hideaway on French Island in Western Port. 11 days ago, during a London concert, she forgot the words to I Should Be So Lucky. Late last year, she made this eerie prediction about her own fate.
It's like being an athlete, and you have to have that kind of focus to be able to do it. I'm a nervous wreck the whole tour. I'm absolutely certain I'm going to get ill or something's going to happen.
Kylie is tiny, but she's big in heart and she's big in mind, and she will overcome this.
Her cancer shock is also likely to attract a flood of international paparazzi into Melbourne, but they've been warned off by the Premier.
Certainly we have strong laws and strong laws about ensuring that no one is unduly harassed.
There's been an overwhelming reaction to the pop princess's illness.
It's great that she's in Australia at the moment and near her family.
Last night, the shock news overshadowed the opening of Greece.
We'll dedicate this one to her and go and kick some serious butt.
Her concert co-star in East Timor, John Farnham, offering his warmest wishes.
You know, I dearly love her and I have great respect. She'll do what she can and go on.
Even the Prime Minister, whose own wife, Jeanette, has survived cancer, was saddened by the news.
It's a reminder, because it's a high-profile person, just how wide is the incidence of breast cancer amongst younger women.
Danny Minogue, who's expected to be flying in to be by her sister's side, has released a statement saying the news is very upsetting, but we are all very optimistic that everything will be okay. Money for Kylie's concerts won't be refunded until her tour is officially cancelled. Presently, her shows have just been postponed, and the promoter says there won't be a decision until more is known about the extent of her treatment.
Melbourne medical experts say the pop princess faces a long and taxing battle with breast cancer that strikes one in 11 Australian women. Specialists say it's likely to be many months or possibly longer before she wows her fans all over again.
She's the girl who's been so lucky, the one who beat all odds to achieve international fame. But now the odds could have turned against Kylie. Medical experts say only 50 in every 100,000 women under 40 will be diagnosed with breast cancer. It's expected she faces immediate surgery.
More commonly these days, the type of surgery that's performed is a wide local excision or lumpectomy, people used to refer it, the removal of the lump with a clear margin of healthy tissue around that.
Because she's too young for routine screening, cancer specialists suspect it's likely Kylie discovered a small breast lump herself. This is a typical tumour.
There is a lesion here in her left breast, which stands out from the surrounding breast tissue.
Why Kylie was unlucky is anyone's guess, but in a small number of cases, family history plays a part. Her father was diagnosed with prostate cancer 4 years ago, and she's yet to have children. This slightly increases the risk for women over 40.
There may well be issues in our environment related to our lifestyle, what we eat, alcohol, smoking, various factors like that.
The odds are good, but there are still no guarantees.
Unfortunately, tend to present with worse tumours. Younger women have a worse outlook in some cases, and therefore the treatment is more aggressive. They just have a greater chance of relapse.
Doctors say 99% of young women in this situation would require chemotherapy. At the very least, it's likely Kylie Minogue will undergo radiotherapy, and she may have to take an anti-breast cancer drug like tamoxifen for up to 5 years.
Treatment can leave women infertile.
The biggest question I get is, why me?
Fans should be just leaving her to her privacy for a while, even though I'm sure she loves their support.
41-year-old Pauline Venn is still waging her own battle against the disease.
Took me back to my early days and what she must be going through.
While 22-year-old Melissa Hale was diagnosed a year ago, she knows what's ahead for Kylie.
If you have a positive attitude, I don't think it's as bad as what everyone says.
You're special to this country, so we're all with you.
There's been a major chemical spill in Sydney's west. Two drums have fallen off a shelf inside a warehouse at St Mary's. One drum leaked chemicals used to make pesticide. 20 people have been found decontaminated at the scene and 5 people have been transported to hospital. 140 workers have been evacuated from the site and 40 firefighters are on the scene. New South Wales Fire Brigade Superintendent Ian Crimmer says the clean-up process is expected to take most of the night.
This particular chemical has sprayed over a fairly large and wide area. It is giving off an odour. People in the area, up to about a kilometre away, are reporting a smell of the odour. We want to assure them there's no health risk whatsoever. We have the fire brigade has the material units constantly monitoring the area. The only risk is to workers in the immediate vicinity, and all those workers have been evacuated.
Deputy Prime Minister and Nationals leader John Anderson says the government must do more to boost drought aid for struggling farmers. Mr Anderson says there was no extra funding in last week's federal budget because the government had hoped for an autumn break in the drought. But he says there is now a need to boost relief following dire warnings from the Weather Bureau.
The thing I've been waiting to see how it would unfold really has been the question of a late autumn break in time to let that wheat crop be sown and to get some pasture growth before winter. It's becoming increasingly unlikely that that is going to happen, and that amounts to a dramatic escalation in the problem, the proportions of the problem that we face.
Mr Anderson has hinted the government will review the situation.
A state of emergency has been declared in parts of New Zealand's North Island. Heavy rain has washed out a bridge on the highway between Tauranga and Whakatane, while many other roads in the region are also affected. A school at Makatu has been forced to close, several houses have been washed away, and local councils are providing sandbags for people to protect their homes and businesses. More than 200 millimetres of rain has fallen in the past 24 hours, and more heavy rain is forecast for tonight.
Still in New Zealand, where 8 tourists have been killed on the North Island after their hire van slid into an oncoming truck in the province of Waikato. Police believe the driver lost control due to wet weather conditions.
It's hard to believe these mangled pieces of metal once formed a roadworthy van.
Well, the van is virtually disintegrated.
A graphic example of just how lethal a road smash in wet and greasy conditions can be. Initial indications are the van may have lost control around a bend in the road and collided with a truck.
The van was just destroyed, it was just torn to pieces. The truck was rolled and into the bank there, and bodies everywhere, just bits everywhere, you know, it's pretty horrible.
8 of the 9 people travelling in the van were dead when emergency services arrived. The sole survivor, an 18-year-old woman, was airlifted to Waikato Hospital with serious injuries. One of the only witnesses, the truck driver, is now providing police with his recollection of the deadly smash.
The driver of the truck is traumatised as a result of it, as you would be expected.
The accident happened just after 9 this morning, the sound of the crash echoing around the area.
Well, it's basically just shotgun material, you know, just a loud bang and went on for a few seconds.
Police say the van was on a private tour of the country and at least 4 of the victims are from India. A decade ago, 8 people died when their house bus plunged off the Mohaka Bridge Bay. The crash today setting another unfortunate record.
Well, I've been in the police for 31 years and this is as bad as I have seen in terms of both the trauma and the number of fatalities, of course, is far too high. It's a very sad accident site.
The serious crash unit is still investigating and police are now contacting the families of those involved.
Well, against all odds, a 47-year-old tourist has been found alive after 10 days lost in the bush on Moreton Island. Rescuers came across South American Ricardo Cerutis not far from where a clairvoyant sensed he would be.
His exhausted rescuers never doubted they'd find him alive. Today their prayers for Ricardo were answered.
A miracle then.
His brother Stanny, who's helped police and SES search the island, could barely contain his excitement.
Yeah, I was going to see him as soon as they pulled him out of the forest.
Found 4 kilometres southeast of the area known as the desert, a dehydrated and exhausted Ricardo lay waiting for help. Sheltering himself from the elements, he was found by SES volunteers around 2:30.
Yes, he's drinking water and that, so at the moment we think he's okay.
Getting him out proved difficult.
It depends if we can work him out or the army going to carry him out.
A paramedic was winched down at 4:30, the breakthrough everyone had been waiting for.
A CAVLITE rescue helicopter has just winched Ricardo from the bushland. He's still alive.
It was a scenario Stanny had wished for, his brother finally safe.
Thank you very much.
Treated on board RACQ Care Flight, Ricardo was flown to Royal Brisbane Hospital for treatment. It's expected he'll make a full recovery. What makes this tale even more extraordinary is the location where Mr. Sirutis was found. An American clairvoyant, Mickey Dean, had sensed his brother was located somewhere in the island's southeast. He never gave up hope of finding Ricardo alive.
No, never. This is why I'm here.
We'll update the headlines next, plus all the latest in finance and sport, including the Waratahs snap up a handy recruit from the Brumbies.
In Baby Boom, unseasonal weather causes confusion for animals in Adelaide.
Sky News, Australia's leader in 24-hour news. Nobody does news. Nobody lives news like Sky News. News on the hour, every hour. At the touch of the red button, Sky News Active. Headlines, sports, weather, latest business, politics and more.
I'm still here.
Every minute, every hour, news is what we do. Sky News is news when you want, not news you have to wait for. On the web and now on your mobile, Sky News is leading the way with tomorrow's technology today. 24 hours a day, nobody does news like Sky News. So why wait to be told later when you can know now? Sky News, Australia's news channel.
Sports will bring you every minute of every game from the NRL, packed into Super Saturday and NRL Sunday, live. It's crunch time in the TUI's new Super 12. We'll bring you all the semi-final action, live and exclusive. Golf, the European Tour will be in Kildare for the Irish Open, live. While the US Tour tees off at the Colonial in Fort Worth, live. That's this weekend on Fox Sports.
Headlines every 15 minutes here on Sky News. Australian Mufti Sheikh Al-Halali says he's received confirmation that hostage Douglas Wood will be released. The Sheikh says he's given Wood's captors the medicine the 63-year-old urgently needs.
Indonesia says it's willing to make a prisoner transfer deal with Australia, paving the way for accused drug smuggler Chappelle Corby to serve her sentence in Australia if convicted. Corby's defence team has called for more government assistance amid a strong-showed public support from the National Poll on her innocence.
Friends, family and colleagues are rallying around Australian pop star Kylie Minogue after she was diagnosed with breast cancer. The 36-year-old is undergoing treatment at a secret location in Melbourne as fans around the world come to grips with her condition.
A look now at Sky News weather. Here's the national forecast. A few showers on the east coast, wind, rain and storms easing in the west. And a reminder that you can access the latest weather on demand at Sky News Active. You just press red.
Dad died. I was left really with nothing to work with, and it was a shock when I found out.
Elvis by the Presleys, coming soon to ABC.
Bellevue is a Category A maximum security prison.
To catch a killer.
We're just trying to save a woman's life.
This cop's become a wanted man.
This is your lucky day, Murphy.
Now.
I didn't kill anyone.
He needs to get proof.
He's inside now. All he's got to do is exploit it.
Get even.
If I promise not to blow you up, will you promise not to kidnap me?
And get out.
Anytime I like, I can wipe you out.
Join a captive audience.
I'll get him.
Murphy's Law, Friday, 8:30 ABC.
I'm leaving tonight. Mean as I can be.
Tonight is Renee Geyer's 21st album and an instant classic. Critically acclaimed as the bravest and most diverse record of her 33-year career.
Guess you think that you're cool.
Renee Geyer's new album, Tonight, is available now from ABC shops, ABC centres, music retailers and online.
Tuesday night, the Treasurer, Peter Costello, hands down his 10th budget, followed by a summary with ABC political correspondent Jim Middleton. Then the most comprehensive analysis when Kerry O'Brien asks the tough questions of Peter Costello and Shadow Treasurer Wayne Swan. What will the budget mean for you? Television's most immediate coverage, Tuesday from 7:30.
Tonight, more questions than answers. The brother of a wrongly deported Australian citizen asks how it could have happened.
It's just a phone call. Like, a phone call will provide them with heaps of answers. I mean, you know, I could have been shouting and no. She's an Australian citizen. She holds an Australian passport.
Well, good evening and welcome to Late Line. I'm Tony Jones. Also tonight, the Immigration Minister, Amanda Vanstone, in her first interview about the search for Vivian Young. She admits her department knew of the wrongful deportation back in 2003.
At some point in 2003, someone at the operational level in Dimia apparently did make a match between the name of the person who'd been sent back to the Philippines and the name of the person that we'd had in detention.
And what happened to that information, Minister? Was it passed up the chain to the Minister at the time or subsequently to you?
No, the advice I have is that it was not, and that's a part of what Mr. Palmer is looking at.
That indicates a level of bureaucratic bungling that almost does border on the criminal, doesn't it?
Well, you've put that question to me before, and as I've said, I'm not going to speculate.
A full interview with Amanda Vanstone is coming up. First, our other headlines. A financial lifeline. The family of hostage Douglas Wood offers a donation to an Islamic charity in return for his release. History wars. Tension over the Soviet occupation of Eastern Europe clouds the 60th anniversary of victory over the Nazis. And no longer the one. Channel 9's chief executive quits and the Packers run on Sam Chisholm from the bench. Well, the family of the Australian mother wrongfully deported to the Philippines in 2001 has broken its silence, expressing concern for her welfare and attacking the federal government. Apparently unaware of her history of mental illness, the Immigration Department deported Vivian Young to a country she hadn't lived in for almost 20 years, severing her ties with her two children and relatives in Australia. We understand she was deported less than 3 days after a car accident in the northern New South Wales town of Lismore, that she was wrongfully detained in a detention centre after the accident, then taken onto an aircraft by wheelchair to be wrongfully expelled from Australia. Our story tonight is reported by Margot O'Neill and Tom Eagledon.
Vivian Young's family in Australia has spent the last 4.5 years in a fruitless search for her in Queensland, not realising her own government had wrongfully deported her in 2001.
It's just a phone call. Like, a phone call will provide them with heaps of answers. I mean, you know, I could have been shouting and no. She's an Australian citizen. She holds an Australian passport. I know because I've seen her passport.
Henry Salon was already worried about his sister before she went missing.
When she showed up here, she sounded, well, not the Vivian that I once knew. She's sick. She's really sick at the time.
But now he fears the worst.
We just hope that she's alive and we're not late. We're not too late in fixing the problem. So yes, we are hoping. My wife and I are hoping that she'd be located and bring back here and, you know, treated to a hospital or something like that.
He's worried his sister was effectively dumped in Manila and was not in a fit mental state to make it back to the family home on the island of Cebu. And Vivian Young's brother is looking for answers from the federal government about how they handled the case when she was initially detained.
You know, I wasn't informed about this, so I mean, if I was informed, then we could have fixed it straight away. Nothing. There's nothing, actually, yeah. They called me up a couple of times, but now that the time has come for them to say, look, finally we found something. We've deported her. At least, you know, but nothing like that.
One of Vivian Young's sisters in the Philippines told Late Line Tonight that she also had no idea where Vivian Young was, and was shocked to learn that the Australian government had deported her. With the family still coming to terms with the bungle that snatched a mother from her children, there are more questions about how the Immigration Department could have got things so wrong. And today, a senior immigration official speaking on condition of anonymity has told Late Line of systemic problems in the department. In the compliance area, people on the whole are a bunch of cowboys. Under so much pressure to deport people, all proper processes have broken down. They put their energy into picking up people and deporting them without proper investigation. The same officer went on to claim, the officials are trying hard to give the government what it wants. Australian and Filipino authorities are continuing their search for Vivian Young. Tom Eagledon, Late Line.
And additional reporting for that story by Lisa Miller from the ABC's Brisbane Bureau. And of course, our interview with Amanda Vanstone is coming up soon. First, it's now down to the final hours before the expiry of a deadline set by the militants holding Douglas Wood hostage in Iraq. They've threatened to kill the Australian if Canberra doesn't begin pulling its troops out of the country by tomorrow morning. It's clear that won't happen, and today the Wood family announced it's prepared to pay what it calls a generous donation to charity to help win his release. That message is being carried to Iraq in person tonight by one of Australia's leading Islamic clerics. Norman Hammond reports.
For Douglas Wood's family, every hour is now precious. With the deadline set by his captors fast approaching, his brother faced the media with another message aimed at those holding the Australian hostage in Iraq.
We empathise with those who have lost loved ones, lost jobs, and lost hope. Out of a sense of moral obligation and solidarity, the family of Douglas Wood will be making a generous charitable donation to help the people of Iraq.
There were no details about how large the donation might be or when it would be paid, but the family is adamant this is not a ransom.
We are trying, as you may have observed in recent days, a number of different approaches to assist resolution of this crisis. Our hope is that a charitable donation may be part of what that assistance can be.
Did the government approve the donation?
I have no comment.
The government wasn't commenting either, but its position has been clear since this ordeal started.
We're certainly not prepared to pay a ransom for the release of people who are taken hostage. The Australian government never has and never will, I suspect, ever do that.
And today, before news of the donation offer was made public, the Foreign Minister said the Wood family knows where the government stands.
But when they say to you, will we abide by any terrorist deadline? Will we withdraw troops? Will we pay a ransom? Is it really difficult to tell a close family member that know we can't do that?
Look, the thing about them is that they know only too well what the Australian government's position is. They've never been in any doubt about that.
Thank you very much. Lovely to meet you. I'm Tulu Prasad.
The family's message to Mr. Wood's captors is also being carried to Iraq by one of Australia's leading Islamic clerics. Sheikh Taj al-Din al-Halali faced some criticism over the weekend for taping a video message asking for Mr. Wood's release, in which he said he understood the jihad of the hostage takers.
We are going to Iraq to help our Australian brother. That's all.
Pray for us.
We feel for his family, and we will do our best to bring brother Douglas Wood home.
He says his first priority will be to use his contacts to try to extend the deadline set by Mr. Wood's hostage takers by 48 hours. But Sheikh Halali won't arrive in Iraq until late tomorrow at the earliest, well after the initial deadline, early tomorrow morning, Australian Eastern Standard Time, expires. Norman Hermont, Late Line.
Victory Day celebrations in Moscow have been clouded by renewed controversy over the Soviet Union's post-war colonisation of Eastern Europe and the Baltic states. Earlier today, a grand military parade was held on Red Square to honour the might of the Soviet Union and commemorate its role in the victory over Nazi Germany 60 years ago. But several Baltic states are still so angry about their forced annexation into the Soviet Union during the war, they've boycotted today's events and are calling for an apology for the atrocities committed in the name of Stalin. Moscow correspondent Emma Griffiths reports.
It was the biggest gathering of world leaders in recent times. Nearly 60 heads of state came to Moscow to pay tribute to the Red Army's victory. On Red Square, they watched as thousands of veterans and troops marched by. In his address, the Russian President Vladimir Putin acknowledged the worldwide suffering, but highlighted the pain still felt in his vast country.
All the peoples of all the republics of the Soviet Union suffered irreplaceable losses. Grief entered every home, every family.
Hitler's army suffered its greatest losses on the Eastern Front. But the Soviet Union's death toll far outnumbered all others. 27 million soldiers and civilians were killed. 60 years after they won, the veterans are just grateful they survived.
On this victory day, we bow our heads, we cry. We should never forget what happened. We'll remember this parade forever. Not only us, young people will as well.
But this anniversary has exposed deep rifts between Russia and its near neighbours over this piece of the past. Eastern European countries and the Baltic states say for them, Victory Day is a day of mourning, a day when their countries fell to Soviet rule. Before the Soviet Union entered the war, it signed a deal with Germany, handing the Baltic states to Joseph Stalin. The Soviet occupation still smarts, and the presidents of Estonia and Lithuania are boycotting Moscow's celebrations.
We are very happy that the World War II on May the 8th was over. But for the Lithuania, Latvia and Estonia, the May the 9th was the beginning of 50 years of slavery.
US President George W. Bush agrees the Soviet domination of its small neighbours was one of the greatest wrongs in history. He promised to raise the issue with his Russian counterpart, but made sure he acknowledged the Soviet victory too.
It is a moment where the world will recognise the great bravery and sacrifice the Russian people made in the defeat of Nazism.
Vladimir Putin is resisting calls to apologise. He says the deal was renounced in the dying days of the Soviet Union. Emma Griffiths, Late Line.
Well, to the upcoming budget now, and it's openly hinting at pleasant surprises, but the Howard government is remaining coy on reports that tomorrow night's budget will include sweeping new tax cuts. Peter Costello has restricted himself to talking only about the welfare to work component of his 10th budget, also leaving unanswered those persistent questions about his leadership ambitions. From Canberra, Greg Jennett reports.
Peter Costello's supporters have been whipping up a sea of dissent over leadership, but there was barely a ripple on Budget Eve.
We're building opportunities for future Australians.
Will it be your last budget, Treasurer?
And in relation to that, we'll be doing the right thing.
He's selling his 10th budget as one of reform.
Responsible measures today for the opportunities of tomorrow. We've got to make sure that we can get our services on a sustainable footing. More people in work, wider participation, a more productive economy.
The emphasis will be on shifting tens of thousands of people from welfare into work through a mixture of incentive and tougher pension rules. Single mothers will be targeted. There'll be extra childcare places, but also a requirement for them to work once their children are in school.
What we hear about is a one-way street where they're going to take the stick to selected groups of welfare recipients. You see, whenever they get into political trouble, they get out there and attack some of the weakest members of our community.
Late drips in the steady stream of budget leaks suggest wide-scale tax cuts may be on the cards. If there are, the government's not giving the game away yet.
Tomorrow's budget, I think, will be a very well-welcomed one, perhaps more so than people might realise at this point in time.
Some economists are predicting a surplus of $13 billion for the year about to end. While it makes tax cuts sound affordable, any move in that direction runs the risk of reigniting demand.
If they dip into the money bag, a temporary money bag, and provide us with big tax cuts, risk is that turns out to be temporary. Everything that Canberra gives us, Sydney and the Reserve Bank takes away in very short order.
This year's budget preparations have been marked by a series of late changes, a symptom, says Labor, of the government's internal leadership wrangling. But as coalition MPs gather back in Canberra for tomorrow's resumption of Parliament, that's an issue they're keen to smother, for the time being at least.
It's not for me to speculate on Liberal Party leadership.
It's a team of great talent. Mr Costello and Mr Howard are both very talented men.
According to a poll in tomorrow's Sydney Morning Herald and The Age, 37% of those questioned say they're less likely to vote for a coalition led by Peter Costello, and nearly two-thirds are convinced John Howard will serve out his current term. Greg Jennett, Lakeline.
Well, back now to our top story on the wrongful deportation in 2001 of Australian mother of two young sons. We've confirmed from family members that Vivian Young had a history of mental illness. Before her deportation, she'd been injured in a car accident in the northern New South Wales town of Lismore. She was taken from hospital to an immigration detention centre in the Queensland town of Coolangatta. In less than 3 days, she was taken onto an aircraft and flown out of the country. Just who met her at the other end is unclear, as is what happened to her after that. Her family has no idea where she is, and nor does the Australian government. Earlier this evening, I spoke to Senator Amanda Vanstone, the minister responsible. Amanda Vanstone, thanks for joining us.
Pleasure.
Can we start by getting you to tell us how many people do you have on the ground in the Philippines right now searching for Vivian Young?
Look, I couldn't give you an exact number, but I can say that the department is working with the Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade and with the Australian Federal Police, who are in turn working with local Philippine authorities to see what we can do to locate this woman.
Has a team been sent from Australia? I mean, do you have any kind of emergency response team for a situation like this who goes to another country to try and find a person missing under these extraordinary and, you'd have to say, tragic circumstances?
Yes, I agree. Look, at this point, we're working with the people that we have in the Philippines, and they are working in turn with Filipino authorities.
How many people do we have in the Philippines?
Well, I couldn't give you the exact number. I'm sorry.
But we've been told that it's Interpol officers who are actually doing the search of these islands, and to date, no Australians are actually involved in the search directly. Is that correct?
Well, look, I can't help you with what you've been told about Interpol officers or who specifically on the ground is doing the work in relation to which agency it might be allocated to.
What have you been told then about the progress of the search for Vivian Young?
Well, that it hasn't at this stage been successful, which is worrying. I would have hoped that we could have located her by now, but I'll get further reports as time progresses.
Well, let's track back to when she arrived in the Philippines. Who met her? I mean, was she met by a local charity and taken to a mental institution? Was she just left to her own devices? I mean, what actually happened to her when she arrived in the Philippines, evidently, yeah, with a history of mental illness?
Well, my advice is that the escort met with someone in the Philippines who was contacted in advance to meet her at the airport from an agency described to me today, not quite as an NGO, more perhaps a Quongo. And efforts are underway to locate and speak to the specific person who met her at the airport when she arrived with the escort officer.
But in how long has this search to find that person who might have some information about Vivian Young been going on?
Look, I can't tell you whether it's, today or yesterday or the day before. I've arrived back from overseas. I got a briefing this morning or this afternoon at least, on where we are. And that's the advice that I have, that we're now not only working through the agencies but specifically trying to find the individual person who met her at the airport, who apparently no longer works for this particular agency.
It's been 4 years now since Vivian Young was deported. Her youngest son is now 9 years old and he's in foster care. Should he not be reunited with his mother?
Well, we're obviously trying to locate the mother, who, because she is an Australian citizen, would be able to come back to Australia if she chose to do so. But until we locate the mother, we can't consider the reuniting aspect.
Well, what about releasing a photograph of Vivian Young so that people in the Philippines might at least know what she looks like?
Well, I think we'll leave it to the professionals to do the job, and if we decide that we come to the point that that's not successful and we have to have a more public search, we can move to that. But right at this moment, it's in the hands of the best people equipped to do that job.
Well, we know quite a deal about her now, in spite of the fact that the government refused to issue any details. We seem to be getting closer to finding out what happened in this case. Why was there so much secrecy from the outset?
The request from her husband at the time and the father of one of the children was for his reasons, and I thought quite good reasons, to make as little known vis-a-vis the woman. Now, I know that doesn't suit the media, and I know people like to know bits and pieces as they find them out, but my general view is that you're best to get all the facts and not tittle-tattle with bits and pieces that you can put together. That's the job we've given Mr. Palmer.
Senator Vanstone, we understand Vivian Young was taken to the aircraft, which took her to the Philippines, in a wheelchair, that she had head injuries from a car accident, that she had a history of mental illness. How could a person in that condition have been deported from this country?
Well, if what you say is correct, I don't have advice with respect to the specific details that you raise. I understand she was in a car accident. She did have some injuries. I've been told that there was a medical clearance for her to go, but I've got some questions with respect to that. She was fit to travel. I've got some questions with respect to that, but I'll have them dealt with through the Palmer inquiry, and I'll get to the bottom of what the facts are. But as I started to say to you, if what you say is correct and that she wasn't fit to travel, it's completely unacceptable. But I want to get the facts of the matter. I've read a number of things in the paper already in relation to this matter that I don't believe are correct. I'm not going to run on the basis of what media reports say. I'll just deal with it piece by piece, fact by fact, till we get to the bottom of it.
Can we deal with this one fact? She has a history of mental illness.
Well, I haven't seen files that indicate that. I mean, I've been told that that's people put that view forward. That may be the case, but I'm not going to get into going through this bit by bit, Tony. It's just not helpful. I think the important thing...
It's in the public interest, isn't it, Minister? I mean, no, for example,
public,
let me go through...
The public
one,
are
let,
interested. Well, let, that's not go, always what the, in the public interest.
Let me go through one detail. Mm-hmm. It appears the decision to deport her took less than 3 days from the time of her car accident till the time she was taken on a wheelchair and put on an aeroplane to wrongfully deport her to the Philippines. Mm. 3 days. Could that be correct?
It could be, but I don't have the files in front of me, and so I'm not going to comment. But I do believe this. I can help you in this respect, that This was quite a short period of time. Let's not quibble about the number of days. Quite a short period of time. And I think that in itself raises questions that need to be looked at.
Too short,
clearly. And that's what Mr. Palmer will be looking at.
You'd say too short, obviously.
Well, as I say, there was a short period of time. An Australian citizen was sent back to the Philippines, albeit, let's put the other side of the ledger here, someone who gave us a name under which, as I understand it, their citizenship is not held. That does make it extremely difficult. With hindsight, when we know who someone is, we can always work out how we could have found that out. But when someone presents and gives a name other than that which in which their citizenship's been attained or in which their passport is held, it does make it difficult.
So, but that's a critical question, though, isn't it? Because what sort of papers was she deported under if she indeed gave you a name which wasn't attached to any passport?
And my advice is she had a Philippine travel document.
In what name?
I haven't asked the specific name that was given under. But it was a travel document given by, obviously, the Philippine government.
Do you believe that all this would have happened in such a short period of time, which you acknowledge yourself, if she had a broad Australian accent and a white skin?
Well, I think it's difficult to try and speculate on what might have happened in different circumstances. I mean, I wasn't there. With respect, Tony, you weren't there.
Well, I mean, how do you respond, though? There are obvious implications here, that there may be racial overtones to this deportation.
I don't think that's appropriate at all or fair. There are many, many people returned every year who come to Australia and either overstay or unlawfully here.
As far as I know, not very many Australian citizens have been wrongly deported. There may be others that we don't know others that we don't know about?
Tony, I'm not suggesting Australian citizens. I'm simply making the point that immigration officers, when returning someone because they have what they believe is a reasonable suspicion that they're unlawfully in Australia, deal with people in a non-discriminatory basis. Obviously, we have people from all over the world who come with a range of accents and a range of skin colours, and it is not my view that that is taken into account.
But you'd agree, in this case, that something has gone awfully, terribly, tragically wrong.
Clearly.
Criminally wrong?
I don't think it's helpful to speculate without knowing the facts. I appreciate that it's of great interest to the media to speculate, and there are some members of the public that like to speculate on what might have happened. But my basic position hasn't changed, and that is when there is a problem, and clearly this is a problem, then the first thing you do is get the facts. Find out what actually happened. Look, the facts on this, Tony, will come out. You can be sure of that. I'll make sure of it myself.
Well, Minister,
Tony, what I'm not prepared to do is, on the way to getting to the bottom of it, on the way to getting the facts, so that we can be answerable to the Australian public for what's happened, what I'm not prepared to do on the path to getting those facts is to speculate.
All right, a senior Immigration Department official who chooses to remain nameless at this point has told us the compliance area of DIMIA is full of cowboys under so much pressure to deport people that all proper processes have broken down. They went on to say they're putting their energy into picking up people and deporting them without proper investigation. How do you respond to that, albeit anonymous, comment from a senior immigration official?
I don't make it a practice to comment on anonymous speculation.
But, Minister, that official says...
Well,
is that official is prepared to give evidence before a royal commission.
Well, you say, Tony, that you have comments from a senior Immigration Department official. And all I say to you is I don't respond to anonymous allegations. What I do say, however, is this. Clearly, as we've agreed earlier in this interview, something here went badly wrong, albeit that the name that was given was not the name that under which citizenship documents were issued in, and that makes it very hard. But we will get to the bottom of this matter. We have got Mr. Palmer looking at it, and we'll look at what Mr. Palmer says as to what the facts are. I am not, in the process of getting those facts, going to deal with speculation or anonymous comments.
Now, that official won't go before the Palmer inquiry because their anonymity couldn't be properly protected.
Well, all I would say to whoever that is if you are an immigration official, presumably you feel an obligation to go forward with your concerns, to go forward within the department and to go to your minister.
Is it true, as it's been reported, the Immigration Department knew as long ago as 2003 that Mrs Young had been wrongfully deported?
I have advised that at some point in 2003, someone at the operational level in Dimia apparently did make a match between the name of the person who'd been sent back to the Philippines and the name of the person that we'd had in detention.
And what happened to that information, Minister? Was it passed up the chain to the Minister at the time or subsequently to you?
No, the advice I have is that it was not, and that's a part of what Mr Palmer is looking at.
That indicates a level of bureaucratic bungling that almost does border on the criminal, doesn't it?
Well, you've put that question to me before, and as I've said, I'm not going to speculate.
We're into a different area now. We're into the area of someone knowing in 2003 that this had happened and not telling anybody.
Look, I can assure you that, as I have a number of times during this interview, we will get to the bottom of this matter. Mr Palmer has the authority to refer both to the Secretary of the Department, who are for any Public Service Act matters that might need to be looked into in terms of disciplinary action under the Public Service Act, and he has the power to make reference of any such matters to any other appropriate authorities.
I have great
confidence that Mr Palmer will do that.
How far up the chain did that information in 2003 that an Australian citizen had clearly been wrongfully deported, how far up the chain did that information go?
Well, Tony, that's exactly the task that we've given Mr Palmer, to find out what happened.
You'd want to know yourself immediately, wouldn't you?
I would like to know, but I will not interfere in the inquiry. I was, when I was first advised of this overseas, very keen for the department to very quickly get on top of what had happened. But as soon as we contacted Mr Palmer, and I think he was right in making this request, that the people involved not be spoken to, that he would speak to them, and I can understand that. You don't want people from the department speaking to potential witnesses before Mr Palmer did. And so,
but other ministers might feel differently about it. You might want to know for your own benefit how far up the chain that information went and not reaching any minister.
Tony, I do want to know that, but I'm happy that Mr Palmer will get that information and he will give it to me. Finally, what I don't think is appropriate, however, is to say to my department, look, I know we've appointed Mr Palmer, but I'd actually like you to go meddling around behind the scenes and give me a bit of other information ahead of time. I've set up the inquiry through Mr Palmer. I have confidence in Mr Palmer, and I will rely on the information that he gives me.
Finally, Amanda Vance.